how simple life really was. Instead of sitting around with family, there was individuals sitting around boxes with screens, and they forgot how to grow their own food. And hunting was replaced by practices which were cruel, and everything seemed to be divided by plastic. And the petrochemical oil, which was extremely toxic, and these people also ran their cars on that oil, which polluted the air and the water and the soil. But the ones who benefited didn't care about the earth. They were only interested in how much the oil was worth. When they started running out, they started fighting for control to secure the world's supply. Petroleum was their goal, so they assembled their armies and their wars destroyed life. They hid the truth from the people, kept it out of their sights. And millions of people were betrayed by these lies, convinced to kill each other and watch each other die. Entire cultures were destroyed before our very eyes. We just sat around and watched the fire falling from the sky. But all the time we knew that it could happen to us. We were living in fear and we were on the same bus. By invading other people, we created more enemies, but they believed that they were doing it to make themselves free. This is the world that I grew up in, so you understand my brain when it begins to spin. Searching for solutions, a better way to be, and I think much clearer when I begin to breathe. So I breathe. Breathe in the air. Yeah, take a deep breath. It's everywhere. Heal my spirit. Heal my body. Heal my soul. Consciousness spinning through sacred
It's everywhere. Heal my spirit. Heal my body. Heal my soul. I know who I am. Consciousness spinning through sacred air. Thank you.
Southern man, get your flag down off that flagpole. I'm sorry, but it is inappropriate in this day and time. Neil Young for you. Good morning. Welcome to Lake County Magazine. I'm Terry Larson.
And Pete the Tax Guy, as usual.
Yes.
And this time I have the pleasure of having my wife for the full show, so I don't have to carry it.
I don't have to work on the news.
And you guys don't have to listen to my type of music.
I have one breaking news story.
Yeah. So anyway.
Yeah. So, breaking news. The gentleman that was killed back on July 2nd in Clear Lake in the avenues, they have apprehended an alleged murderer of him. And we're very happy to see that Clear Lake PD followed up on leads that were given to them by local citizens. And they believe there are more citizens out there. Oh, please don't even go there. That there are more citizens out there that know about this murder. The young man, his name was Stephen Galvin, but he was also known as, let me get his nickname up here. He was very well loved, too. Yeah, I'm going to get his name in a second. Why don't you go ahead and talk for a minute? But very tragic. It was it came right up in his yard and just shot him and killed him. And we're very really, really, really brazen type of murder in all respects of the word. He was 40 years old. And,
a youngster.
Yeah. And T-Bone. That's what T-Bone. They called him. Mm. Yeah, so T-Bone, Stephen Galvin, was killed on July 2nd. And they have now arrested 35-year-old Clear Lake resident Billy Mount. He previously was arrested for outstanding warrants on July 5th. Of course, he is in Lake County Jail with the charge of murder in this case and other charges. During the investigation, it was learned that there may be possible witnesses, so they would like to speak to anybody that may have seen this. They got the guy, and hopefully they're going to keep the guy for a while. So if you have a way to help them do that, please contact the Clear Lake Police Department. Their phone number is 994-8251, extension 320, and you can talk to Detective Ryan Peterson. So this is very important. T-Bone was well-loved. It seemed like he had a lot of people that really depended on him and appreciated him. So we want to see justice in this case. So if you know something, by all means, please contact the Clear Lake PD. That's my public service announcement for
today. And we should have a very exciting show today. We have Assemblyman Bill Dodd calling in at approximately 9:30 to kind of talk about the $1 million that was earmarked for Clear Lake.
That Governor Brown.
That Brown said, I don't think so, and crossed it out.
I just don't understand that, you know.
Brown is a...
He doesn't realize the damage that's being done to the downstream. It's not just Clear Lake. It affects the entire, what do they call it, the Delta and the Bay Area.
Well, he doesn't care about Northern California.
Obviously not.
And remember, he is a Democrat, but he's a fiscal conservative,
he calls himself. But so why doesn't he cut the fat in other places?
Well, like the $3 or $5 billion transit rail system from nowhere to nowhere.
Thank you.
Yeah. So anyway, we're going to ask Mr. Dodd about alternative plans, grants, loans, whatever, to see if he can bring some money into Clear Lake to help resolve the issue with the lake. And then at 11:00, we have the new commander in chief. That's my title, not his, for CHP and Clear Lake. He's coming on the show live and in person to answer our questions. So it'll be interesting to have him in here to find out what his goals are, the direction he wants to take CHP here locally, and some other questions we have prepared for him. So that should be a very interesting thing. Can't believe I'm going to talk to law enforcement.
Why? I think it's a good thing. I mean, I'm really excited because he's new. And of all the law enforcement agencies, the CPD does seem to have the most going for it. I mean, the CHP does seem to have a lot going for it. I'm not going to say anyone is better than anyone other, but they seem to have less problems than other law enforcement agencies. So they're doing something right over there. And our good friend Glenn Thomas is one of the officers, so I have to give him a shout out
okay.
for being a good CHP officer.
No, it's funny, is not that I ever
My uncle also was in the CHP until he retired.
Right.
Retired don't commander, actually.
Yes. Yeah. But I think it was on Facebook, which I really don't pay much attention to, but there was a derogatory post about law enforcement in general,
mm-hmm.
and someone here locally responded saying, you know, that's a very general statement. Officer White of the Sheriff's Department, who we had a pleasure of meeting at our house mm-hmm. due to our goat situation, he was extremely pleasant and very thorough and actually was very sincere in following up on the case. Glenn, we know through friends and family, well, not direct family, but family.
Friends, that are like family.
Yeah. He's always very professional and very good on his job. So there are good people in law enforcement. There's just some bad apples that cause a rift.
Bad when a law enforcement officer says that his police department is the biggest gang in whatever area.
Yeah.
It kind of makes things look bad.
It does. So, you know, we have some questions for
allegedly.
Allegedly, so. Yes, of course. Even though it's kind of been confirmed. But anyway, so we should be a good show. So we'll rant and rave for a little bit between guests. Hopefully Mr. Dodd will have some extra time to spend with us today. So, and then we have some other news stories we can cover. Hopefully everyone had a great July 4th weekend.
Boy, we had a nice one.
We did?
Yeah, it was very relaxed.
It was very relaxing, absolutely.
Yeah, we had some people in from out of town, and our friend Chris, who's actually applying for a job today at the French Laundry, we're really excited for her. Well, not at the restaurant, but she's a permaculture person and a horticulturalist.
Is that too expensive for our blood?
No, well, probably, but we're going to splurge one day. I told her it's on our bucket list.
What can she buy?
One does need to make reservations way ahead
like
of time.
Like 2 years ahead
so
of time.
So it's, what's it called again?
The French Laundry.
Okay.
It's in Napa.
Oh, I think I saw that on TV.
Yeah. It's a big time.
So place. It's kind of like fufu?
Well, I don't know, but she said there's like a 3-acre plot of land right across the street from the restaurant that they grow their culinary.
Right. So is it really a true French restaurant, or is that just the name?
From what I understand, yeah. It's a Michelin chef.
Okay, so I could go down there, sample the fare, and compare it to my father's old restaurant.
Good
and
luck.
See if they're any good or not.
If you remember everything
of course I
from
do.
Way back then.
Absolutely. Absolutely remember. Wasn't that young. I was in my preteens and teen years.
Okay.
Okay, anyway. So that's good to hear, I think. Yes. We have some other news story, but July 4th, we actually did nothing, right? We had a nice little barbecue out on the...
That was the good thing about it. We didn't go anywhere.
Yeah.
We stayed home.
And then not realizing it, we actually had magnificent views of the Clear Lake fireworks from our dock.
What do you mean not realizing it?
I never realized it.
Well, we
discovered
it last year.
Well,
so
I didn't remember.
You didn't remember. That should be better said, yes.
I remember having boat problems and being towed.
We had boat problems last year. We thought we'd be smart. We'd take the boat down like everybody else does to the harbor there around Clear Lake and watch the fireworks from the water. But
it didn't work out quite that way.
No, the little engine that could said no mas.
No mas. So we got towed to our dock.
And give thanks to White Brothers for coming to our rescue. It just so happened they were in the area, so it was very helpful.
Yeah, but I don't remember.
And they knew to look out for us because they knew our little boat was kind of
But I didn't know that
dicey.
We saw the fireworks.
Yeah, so we had to pull the boat right up to the dock,
right.
Tie it down, and we stayed right there and watched the fireworks.
And who was with us?
Cheryl.
Anyone else?
But she went back up. She didn't stay for the fireworks.
Carlton was with us, wasn't he?
Carlton? Yeah, but he didn't come down. He wasn't with us on that, I think.
Okay.
I don't know. I think those two went upstairs or something. All I remember is we were by ourselves. And it was beautiful. And we're so perfectly positioned for the Clear Lake fireworks that you can actually see them launching from the ground. I guess they're in the park right in front of the city hall. And they just take... You see them going right up. You know exactly when they're coming, and it's really fun.
Yeah, well, it was
beautiful, and they say it was one of the best fireworks. I think last year was better, but it was a very good show.
Yeah.
And kudos to the Lakeshore Lions Club and all the people that contributed to the fireworks fund to help them raise the money for this.
Well, being
as awesome.
Simple-minded as I am at times,
mm-hmm.
I like the effect of the fireworks going off with all sparkling lights and colors and stuff, and then hearing the boom, which tells you that light travels faster than sound.
Sound, yes.
So it was a scientific lesson.
I'm
to
so
reinforce.
Glad you finally learned something at 60-something years old.
Don't tell the people how old I am.
I didn't. I said 60-something.
Well,
they
that's,
can guess
that's
what
old.
The something is.
I'm not on Social Security yet, folks.
Not yet. Not that old.
Well, I do qualify.
If you want to take her.
Yeah, I chose not to.
I'm glad.
Yes.
We need to save that for when we're really old.
Yeah, I need that big check. When
and we really can't work.
I need that big check at 65.
There's no IRAs. There's no 401ks.
Well, no, hang on. I have a pension.
Yeah, you
a
have
pension.
A stipend from.
Hang on. I have a pension fund from working for American Airlines.
Sky Chefs.
Yes, but it was owned by.
I understand,
yeah,
but.
It was Sky Chefs.
Yes.
And I worked for them for 10 years. I had a decent job, finally, that towards the end.
You were their comptroller.
Comptroller at Kennedy Airport.
Yeah.
And I received a letter a few years ago saying, we need to update your address, so when you qualify, yada, yada, yada. And I went the paperwork through and sent it back to them. I get this letter back saying, thank you for responding. And based on our current calculations, you're going to get $79 a month. You think that'll buy me enough beer for the month, I guess.
Oh, my God. Plus your Social Security. We should be all set.
Well, you get Social
Security.
Well,
we have, yeah, mine is like.
But you get the minimum. That's okay.
I get like $300 a month or something.
Well, by the time we do it, you'll get.
I worked so much with, you know, or didn't even work most of the time. You know, I got government assistance when I was raising my kids. So.
You'll get the minimum, which would be $450 at the time, plus mine. So we'll get, we'll survive.
Exactly.
Yeah, as long as we're debt-free, we'll survive. Unlike some people in Lake County have these massive pensions from their school board and from unions and PG&E and all that good stuff. And more power to them.
That's right.
They worked hard for it. So anyhow, so we had a great 4th of July. I hope everyone had a good one and a safe one out there. I actually did not play baseball this weekend.
Yay.
Which probably...
Cats and the dog were so happy that we stayed home for a full day without going anywhere, both of us. To have us both home all together, you could have seen the smiles on their faces.
Even Coach, you just like,
they were so happy.
Yeah. Sydney just looked at us and said,
I was
sleep.
Glad. Yeah.
Though it was kind of a rough week, though. We did have some AC problems.
Yeah.
And for about a week.
It was a hot week.
We had some kind of cool air blowing into the house from the fan, but the compressor, the fan wasn't working on the AC unit, and we almost burnt up a compressor.
Nice.
But Jonas came out on Monday, replaced the condenser that had blown, and we now have cold air again.
Yes, and thanks to them for a speedy recovery. We didn't have to wait for the part. They had it on.
No, they had it on. The guy said, I just restocked my van, so we should have the part on hand here.
Excellent.
So that was
excellent.
Nice.
Yeah, that's
but it was a very warm week.
And we're much more comfortable now.
Well, you are.
Except you're freezing.
I am.
Well, if you get some meat on your bones, you won't be freezing, okay?
Well, you know, I'd rather
this man
be
is losing weight like crazy.
Slim and trim than the opposite.
If you say
but
so.
Unfortunately, the cold does bother me. And my poor shoulder right now.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
Anyone who's a doctor out there listening?
He has medical care, but he never likes to take advantage of it.
Well.
So getting him to call a doctor and make an appointment, it just doesn't happen.
Yeah, like I say. I did a self-diagnosis through WebMD, and it appears that I have crushed my blood vessels and my nerve right on my collarbone. What's it called? The cervix?
No.
Wrong one. Sorry, folks.
You don't have one of
those.
No,
I know that. What's it called? The collarbone?
The collarbone.
No, there's a name for it.
I don't know.
Anyway, and that goes all the way up to my neck, so I can't raise my arm high. I can't extend it. But if you do go to a chiropractor, you know, they do this type of pressure on your arm. See, this one I can handle. This one my arm won't do. So that tells me my shoulder's all screwed up. But I'm going to pitch anyway.
I know. I just can't even talk to you about it anymore because I'm just tired of hearing the complaints.
What complaints? I don't complain.
Don't let him fool you.
I only complain because the air conditioning blows right on my shoulder.
He complains about the air conditioning, complains about the pain. And I can't feel sorry for you because you continue to beat your body up.
I don't expect sympathy.
I'm so glad.
What's that song? I don't want no sympathy.
I guess.
Yes.
It's almost time for a caller. Do you want to take a quick break? Do we get him on? Or
if you want.
Oh, and Mark, if you'll put the phone number up there.
Yes,
really
I just
good.
Had it up. I'll put it up one more time.
Oh, you did. Okay.
Yeah.
So, yeah, when Bill Dodd will be calling in, but we have two lines, so you can call in and ask him questions during the conversation if you want. You see our number. And just give us a call.
You know,
I think it's going to be very interesting. Yeah. Every time we talk to him, we have fun.
He's a good guy.
Yeah.
Even when we see him out in public and at fundraising events or whatever the case may be, he's always very polite and recognizes us. And
he's a good man. Yeah. And he's working hard for Lake County.
Yes,
that's
he
what
is.
I really appreciate.
He really is
anything.
Keeping his campaign promises
yep.
in regards
he's
to Lake County
his
and trying his best, right?
Yeah.
So, and I guess
that's
it was
all
it.
We can ask.
And Mark. Senator McGuire and him were working together on this funding, right? So. We've never had McGuire on the program, have we?
No, we haven't. I've reached out a couple times, but they haven't responded.
Yeah, maybe Mr. Dodd will lend a helping hand.
Maybe.
Maybe.
I'm not going to, if he wants to help, that's fine.
Yeah, that can be pushy.
Right.
Yes, so anyway. So, hopfully Mr. Dodd will call in on time, but with his, ha ha ha, as
and
we
he
say,
is on
he's
time.
On time. I love that. So, you going to answer?
Yep.
Please.
Okay. Hello there.
Congratulations. Your business has been approved for a $250,000 loan.
Really?
I don't think that's Bill Dodd.
That's cool. Folks, anyone out there want a $250,000 loan?
Oh, what perfect timing
that was. Oh. I should have said if it was collateralized or not. And what credit scores do you require? So, anyway, did you want to take a quick break, or you just want to continue rambling?
Well, I'm sure everybody's tired of the rambling.
Well, we got plenty of things to talk about. We got lots of good stories.
Well,
events could happen.
You can start
around.
Talking about some of that.
Well, by the way, folks, I said besides the good guests that'll be with tantalizing conversations today, we actually invited Mr. Phil Murphy on our show next week, and most people know Phil around the county and his vocal output on issues around the county. And there's been an issue with Ready Cement, Clear Lake, that's actually based in Kelseyville. They've been shut down twice so far this year due to lack of permitting and environmental concerns. And Phil's been on top of this for us. And so I asked him to come on the show next week to go into a little bit more detail than what we can put into an article on our magazine. So I think that's going to be a very, very interesting conversation in regard to... what's it called? The planning and development?
Community development.
Thank you. Community development department. Also, right now, we were told that the State Water Resource Department is actually on site there looking at the concerns and problems, and that could have some significant ramifications on Ready Cement. So Phil will be here next week to discuss that. Hopefully we'll have some more follow-up on that story. But for those who are like to talk about local events or concerns in regard to how our government reacts to certain situations or lack thereof, it should be a really good interview. So... stay tuned next week, same time, same place, same station. And we also are putting our schedule for Lake County Magazine Talk Show up on lakecomagazine.com site, so you can see what guests are going to be appearing in the future. We're really making an effort now to make sure we get some good quality guests and stories on
and
the
tell
air.
Your friends, too, because I know there's a lot of people that can't reach us through technical issues with our streaming site, Silverlight, and all of that good stuff. So we do have a YouTube channel.
Yes, we do.
It's called Lake County Magazine, right? Is that right?
Lake County Magazine,
okay.
Yes.
So if you have somebody who wants to watch the show and they can't see it live, they can watch the repeat either on YouTube or on the LakeComeMagazine.com website in the 2015 archives.
Right.
So we're working on improving our product very, very quickly and hoping that we can get that we can get everything pulled together.
Right. Well, we also have a discussion taking place this week, which may allow our viewers and listeners to pick up our show on radio. But I'm not going to go further than that because there's no guarantees at this point in time. But if it does come about, we will – the upper part of Lake County and possibly up to Lakeport will be able to pick up the signal.
Oh, with KMEC?
Well, I wasn't going to say that, but go ahead now.
Yeah.
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 Because it's not finalized.
KMEC, it is. They're broadcasting.
No, but we haven't.
Oh, our agreement to share programming. Right. No, that's something that's going to be hopefully coming in the near future. But they are actually broadcasting. Those of you who live in Upper Lake should be able to get their signal. It's 105.1 FM. And they have some wonderful programming there.
They do.
They have very progressive minds working in the programming aspects.
Would you like to give them their frequency?
I just did, 105.1.
Oh, 105.1, folks.
105.1.
Oh, stop.
Oh, there you go.
Look, you're not the guest today, so mellow out.
Man.
Okay. But, you know, folks, if you try to pick up their signal, I would appreciate, or we would like to appreciate, some feedback. Either Facebook us, call us, or email us. We'd like to know how far that signal can go into Lake County. So I personally believe, based on my conversation with KMEC, that it could get as far as Lakeport and possibly even further. The reason I say that is that their objective for putting a repeater up on Black Bart Trail, God, I got that set.
Just above Lake Mendocino.
Right, is that they believe that their repeater will take the signal all the way into all of Lake County.
So, yeah, we haven't been able to test it yet, but I want to try it in the Jeep and see if we can pick it up.
Right. So we're meeting with their board to discuss a mutual relationship where we'll carry each other's programming.
Oh, boy. Where's Mr. Dunn?
Oh, he's a busy man.
Email.
So that could
so
be
hard to get this organized.
Yeah. KMEC had been entertaining the thought of having their own daily news show. And I think they realize.
I think they are doing it.
Oh, are they?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, I don't think I'm not sure if they're doing it every day, but I think they are doing
it. So hopefully we can combine efforts and provide a better quality programming and a more consistent programming. So that's exciting to us because we know that there are many, many people out there who like to listen to us for whatever reason. And they can't pick up our show on the internet because they don't have internet or they have AT&T and the signal just is too slow for them. So having a radio station available at least allow you to listen, which could be better than having to look at us all day. Even though my wife is absolutely beautiful and gorgeous. But me, on the
You're
other
so
hand,
full of it.
Is old and decrepit.
And sexy and handsome.
Yeah, whatever. So, ask Sam Elliott.
See, mutual admiration aside.
Yeah, ask Sam Elliott.
Hey, he's hot. But you're hotter.
No, he's a nice man, I guess.
Because he cut his hair. He's
but
so
he's
hot.
So conservative looking these days. I like him in his old Roadhouse days. Long hair, couple days growth beard, Mr. Macho Man, riding a cycle. So, anyway, shall we continue moving forward with real conversation?
Yes, please do.
Well.
No, I'm very excited about the KMEC meeting. I think we're going to have some good response out of that. And, you know, they have an activist role in the Mendocino area that they've been trying also to carry down into here. There's a lot of back and forth between the Lake County activists and Mendocino activists. So it's very exciting. And we're looking forward to seeing where it develops into.
Well, they showed a very keen interest. So
yes.
We'll go from there.
So we're having two meetings, one with the board and one with the programmers.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. So.
Excellent.
So on another note,
yes,
has anyone here encountered a shark attack?
Dun,
it
dun,
is Shark
dun,
Week.
Dun, 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 dun.
Is it Discovery Channel?
Oh, my gosh. Discovery Channel, Nat Geo, you name it, sci-fi.
It's Shark Week, folks.
Sharknado 3.
Oh, God.
Oh, hell no.
You know we'll end up watching it sooner or later.
I know. We haven't watched it yet. But haven't watched the first one or the second one, folks.
Well, we watched the first one
but
for
this
like
one
5 minutes.
Is supposed to be so packed full of, for about 30 seconds.
Yeah, of sharks falling out of the sky.
Yeah, well, it's so packed full of cameos.
Oh, that's right.
Yes,
that's right.
There's going to be a lot of crazy famous people in there, and it should be a lot of fun. I'm looking forward to it, actually.
Unfortunately, on a serious note, that there have been tremendous amount of shark attacks.
What's up with that?
What, the North Carolina area?
I want to say South Carolina.
South Carolina,
north.
Yes.
It was north? Okay.
I believe so, yeah.
Well, maybe it's both, because we up and down the East Coast, there have been a lot of attacks.
And there's one on the West Coast here recently.
Yes. Yeah. And I think they said that there were 21 attacks or something like that.
Which is very unusual.
Very.
So the question is, what's generating these attacks? Is it the warm water? Because they're cold water type animals.
That would be my guess.
Yeah. So, matter of fact, I was watching, because it is Shark Week, I think it was Discovery that I was watching last night for 5 seconds, and I stayed on the channel because I saw a map of Australia, and I'm kind of inclined to listen to programming about Aussie, and they were emphasizing where the great white sharks habitate, and of course...
Okay.
What?
Habitate.
That's what I said.
Okay.
What, didn't I?
Fine.
What did I say?
Habitate.
Thank you. So why are you correcting me?
I don't know if that's correct, but I'm not going to...
Where they live. How's that? That better?
Yes.
Okay. Where they hang out at. Obviously, in the New South Wales area, which is the southeastern part of Australia, for those who think Australia speaks a different language. And they also hang out at the southwest area, which is in the Perth area, where a lot of diving takes place. And then, of course, in the slightly colder waters around Melbourne, Victoria, where I was born. It's interesting. There's shark attacks here all the time, but we have netting that protects the bays, and we have lifeguards that are very sincere about their job, and they have different flags for different things on all the beaches. And they have it for riptides, they have it for sharks, they have it for excessive beer drinking.
If there's such a thing in Australia.
Yeah, there's no such thing as excessive, it's just a matter of when you stop.
So now, is this excessive drinking by the sharks themselves, or?
No, they have an eating frenzy occasionally.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, of human flesh.
See, now, I think that it's either due to maybe an increase of shark population, which means that they're having to look for more food source, more plentiful food source, or their food source to begin with is starting to dry up.
Well, like seals?
Yeah.
That's true. That's why you never wear a black wetsuit.
Yeah, not the best idea.
To look like a seal, yeah.
Yeah. No pun intended, because we wear gray.
Okay.
My baseball team's called the Seals, guys. So.
Oh, and a couple of them kind of look like seals.
Hey. They're trying hard.
They're doing good.
They're
lost
trying
a lot of
hard.
Weight. I'm very
weight.
Happy for
yes.
them. Very proud of them, actually, to
yes.
see that.
They're yeah. And they're good guys.
And forgive me for saying that, but it is kind of ironic.
So they're beach seals versus beached whales. They used to be beach whales. Now they're just beach seals. Never mind.
I don't know, but they better start winning or they're going to be dead seals.
We're dead in the water as it is. Our
poor baby.
You know, here's, and I know they're not, well, Gino might be listening because he's bored to death. He has no more construction work now. And Monty might listen because he's retired from the water company in what's the town near Hillsburg?
Windsor.
Yes. So, but... yeah, our I'm going to have a little speech.
Well, I'm very, very, very happy that the guys did try to, you know, at least get in better physical shape.
No, they are. They're really trying hard.
And they are trying hard. They and are. I don't want to belittle them in any way.
Oh, no.
They're awesome people, and they play good baseball, let's face it.
The only problem
though
is...
Though this year has been kind of a bummer,
yeah,
it's still good baseball.
Yeah, when you're a little bit overweight playing baseball, depending upon what position you play... Sometimes those ground balls go right through the wickets. And those who don't understand cricket, that goes mean right between your legs.
And sometimes it's hard to reach down
they
there.
They just can't reach down there.
That's the biggest problem you have when you're that size.
One of the gentlemen is a catcher, and he's a great catcher with a very strong arm. Knows how to call a good game, but he can't move behind the plate. So if you throw
a
ball.
He's not overweight.
Yeah, he is. Not Monty,
the
other one.
I don't know the other one. Do I?
I don't want to mention names.
No, I know. Okay, then we'll talk about it later.
Yeah, the guy that does credit cards.
Okay.
Okay. He just can't move behind the plate too fast. So if you throw a ball in the dirt on the outside corner, he just can't adjust his body fast. Now, Monty, he can. He is a very good catcher. Calls a great game. Matter of fact, this is my third season throwing to Monty. And he doesn't really need to even give me a sign. We're on the same wavelength now where I know exactly what he's going to call. And maybe once a game I'll shake him off. But it's nice to have that type of telepathic. Is that the right word? Telepathy? Telephonic?
Telepathic.
Telepathic communication skills, which is like, and those who've been married for a while understand this, like I have with my wife. I know exactly what she's going to say to me when she's upset.
Yes, you do.
And I know when I make corny jokes what she's going to say. And sometimes we just read each other's mind because we have things going on. Okay. All right, Mr. Dodd.
Yeah.
You sure it wasn't 10 o'clock?
It's 9:30.
Oh, okay.
Well, he has an opening between 9:30 and 10:30, basically.
Okay, so he might be just getting to the office and hanging out there.
So I sent his assistant an inquiry. So
okay,
see.
Cool. So,
and
anyway.
You know what? He's a busy man.
Yes,
so
he is.
If he doesn't make it, he'll make it again another time.
Yep, he's always very good at following up. So, anyway, Shark Week is interesting. Thank goodness we don't have a lot of shark attacks in this area. hopefully.
That should be him. Yeah.
Okay.
Looks don't like forget him. To turn the mic on.
Thank you. At and do I need too. To pot it up too?
Yeah, I believe
okay.
so.
Hello.
Oh, God.
Hey.
Hey,
how you doing, sir?
How are you?
Hey,
it's not like you have. It's not like you have nothing else to do.
Hang on 1 second while I get your mic up. Okie dokie. Now you can say hello. Can you say yeah? Can you say hello for us?
Hi, this is Bill Dodd.
He knows that coming through, Mark.
That's coming through. Yes.
He knows his own name.
Yeah, how about that?
That's more than I can say sometimes.
Oh, you must be so tired. You must be so tired of saying that, though.
He's not kind of painting anymore. He doesn't have to.
Repetitive. Yeah, so how are you today?
You know, really good. Really, really good. I think that we're getting a lot done up here. And, you know, obviously we're here to talk about Clear Lake. And I'm pretty proud of what we've been able to accomplish in a very short period of time.
Well, we agree with you on that, and I guess Senator McGuire has been very working with you on this.
Oh, I'm telling you, Senator McGuire has been just a great, great partner in this. You know, not just this, my low-income rate assistance. We've also got a bill we're working on together, the career technical education.
Excellent.
A lot of bills that really fit the mold for small rural communities like you have in Lake County.
Awesome.
Well, without trying to kiss up to you, I'm going to basically tell you that I'm extremely pleased and proud that you are keeping with your campaign promises or your campaign agenda. And it's very rare for me to say that to any politician. So
that's true.
I'm very negative when it comes to most politicians. So I'm very pleased to see that you are actually keeping your promises.
Well, maybe we've set a new standard, so we're going to have to work even harder. In the future. But that's I think it's worth doing. You know, another thing that it's coming later than we anticipated, both Senator McGuire and I. But we, you know, this long-awaited state office up in Lakeport is going to happen. We just got put into the bureaucracy of. The state, because you know, the state has never had an office in Lake County. Plus, if you can believe this, the state and the assembly have never cooperated together on putting a joint office anywhere. And so, you know, there was all sorts of red tape. And I'm proud to say that I think this month that office will be opening up in Lakeport.
Man,
excellent!
That is fantastic.
Can you keep us advised on that date?
Yes,
so
we please.
Can,
well, we get all the emails right
well,
now.
Well, that's true. I forgot.
I
about
would
that.
Assume
we will. And then I hope both Mike McGuire and I both want to have an open house up there and both be there at the same time and kick it off and meet people throughout the Lake County area.
Would you be
awesome?
Would you be receptive? to us potentially, you don't have to make a commitment on this, for us to possibly do a live stream of that open house?
I can make a commitment to that right now.
Oh, okay.
Cool. Well, thank you. Because
I think that'd be cool, for at least, you know, for people that, you know, they can't get there. Right. The travel is just a little bit too
right.
much, but enjoy,
right.
You know, listening to, you know, to you guys and learning more about what's going on. I think that'd be fantastic.
Awesome. As long as you have an internet connection, we're good.
Yes.
Well, we better, because next door, so I'm sure they do.
Excellent. And where's the location again?
It's on Lakeport Boulevard. It's where the Ag Commissioner's Office is, kind of just below the Chamber of Commerce.
Oh, okay. Hill. Okay.
You know, where instead of going up to the Chamber, you kind of go around that hill.
Yep.
To
yep,
the
yep.
agriculture.
Down below where the Ag Commissioner's Office is.
Oh, okay. Well, that's a good location.
Right. So let's get to the crux of the issue today, and that is, with all of your effort that you and Senator McGuire put forth, obviously Governor Brown decided not to agree with the two of you, and to the best of my understanding, he basically recommended that we go for grants and other avenues to raise the money for Clear Lake.
How do you feel about that?
You know, we were disappointed. We thought that... We had the collective wisdom of the Assembly and the State Senate, and we brought this thing through the different budget subcommittees and the budget committees and conferences, and got all the way through that. Many people looked at Clear Lake and saw how important of an issue this was, not only to the people of Lake County, but to the state of California. And to get that all the way through,
say
it was nothing short of a miracle, because it was a very good project and something that had a lot of merit. But nevertheless, I think the short answer is, you've got 80 assembly members, you got 40 senators. I think the governor's office doesn't want a precedent being set of potentially having earmarks from all the legislatures over time. And I think that, I don't know if you were able to read the governor's statement that the Department of Fish and Wildlife and the State Water Resources Control Board, their statement on this. Were you able to read that?
No, I think I saw it, but I don't think I read it.
Yeah, I saw Governor Brown's comments.
Essentially, the governor approved, while we wanted to see him approve the allocation for it, we think the governor's direction to appropriate the state agencies to work in this upcoming budget year to help secure the needed funding is really important. I think that he sees and his staff sees the significant need, and so they... In most times, when he blue lines a budget item, it's done, it's over. You can have another shot at it next year. But in this particular case, we not only had the governor, but his top water agencies within the state of California agreeing that this was something that needed to be done. And not only are they going to help work to secure funding sources for this item, they're also going to help with technical assistance to the county and any other resource agencies up there that will need some help crafting the type of applications they'll need to secure that type of funding. And so I think from that standpoint, you know, we can really be encouraged that, this is not going to go away. But this is now, what I don't want to do is, this is no longer, this is an administration issue, but rest assured that, Senator McGuire's office and my office will be working with these resource agencies to make sure that we're doing everything that we can in our power to push them towards implementation of this recommendation that they've made.
Well, without stating the obvious, and I'm sure they are aware of this, but do they understand, I mean, when I say they, I'm talking about this government in Sacramento, do they truly understand the impact that Clear Lake has on the rest of our area between here and Sacramento?
And the Delta area,
the
pollution, the issues.
Yeah,
that...
we've had conversations with the directors in our office here, And the only thing they didn't like about this is the funding source, and it was a tough funding source for them to approve. They all genuinely understood the issue and the problem, so I'm encouraged by that. And I'm also encouraged by the governor giving them direction, because short of that, you can talk to state agencies all day long, but if their boss doesn't give them a direction that, yes, this is what we want to do as an administration, then it's harder for them, you know, just to go off on that mission on their own. So I remained optimistic, but vigilant on instructing my staff to work with these agencies to make sure we're moving in the right direction.
Okay. So do you believe that within 1 to 2 years we should potentially have some funding coming in?
Yeah, I do. I do. I heard the commitment, you know, the governor just generally does not issue press releases encouraging something, money to be spent on something that he blew lines.
Yeah, right? That's just odd.
So in this particular case, you know, he had at least a full-page press release on, you know, not only the importance of this, but how they were going to help, very, very specific. And so both the senator and I am appreciative of Governor Brown's efforts on our behalf and behalf of the people of Lake County.
Okay, so you feel he is going to stand up eventually, and we're going to get some kind of relief somewhere,
yes.
But just not from this source.
And Senator McGuire's staff is also working with Lake County officials at the County of Lake and your other resource agencies up there, and also they're going to be working with nonprofits, non-government organizations, anybody else that is interested in projects that will help preserve Lake County. And the one silver lining to this whole thing is the very potential, if we had gotten this budget allocation, we know the maximum allocation we would have received was $1 million. In this particular case, there really isn't a ceiling. And I just think that we have two missions, working with the state here, but also working locally. And Supervisor Steele and others up there in Lake County are working on trying to get everybody together to get some sort of consensus on what projects will be, you know, bring the biggest bang for the buck, so that your projects score well in the big scheme of things when those applications go well in.
Right. So all parties concerned will have some type of input on how the money is going to be spent. So it's not going to be just the county level.
Not just the county level. No, the state and state agencies are going to be involved. I think there should be a process even, up in the Lake County area. This is, should be a real transparent process. I'm not saying, once it gets up to the director of Fish and Wildlife or State Resources, it's going to be all that transparent because they don't have the same rules and regulations. But certainly, as we work with the County of Lake and they have to go through the Board of Supervisors to get something approved, that, there's the Brown Act and all that entails,
right.
So people will have their opportunity to be heard.
Right. Well, I'm sure you're aware of that. There's a lot of controversy up here regarding how to fix the lake, and we have several citizens of Lake County that are very outspoken, to say the least, in regard to the projects that have been discussed by our board and the lack of real detail involved. And that's why I asked that question. So it's not going to be just Lake County officials. It's going to be up to the state also to figure out what the best bang for the buck, basically.
Mm-hmm.
Right, but I think this is a wake-up call, hopefully, for the people of Lake County and us as your elected representatives to work together to present the most coherent, technically based, science-based plan to increase the chances of getting this important money for Clear Lake.
Right. Okay, I'd like to change the subject just for a bit, if you don't mind.
Sure.
Recently, I saw an article or some comments from the governor's office. I don't know if Mr. Brown said this himself or not, that our roads in throughout the whole of California are deteriorating faster than we can repair them. And as you might be aware of, there's been several measures on the Clear Lake ballot in regards to passing a new road tax. We have probably one of the highest gas taxes in the nation, in this state, yet our roads are in disrepair. And I saw that they wanted to raise the gas tax like almost 40 cents per gallon and look at other avenues of raising funds. Do you have any input on that or any knowledge about what they may be or may not be doing?
Well, yes. The Assembly, Speaker Tony Atkins, selected me to the Infrastructure Special Committee that will be meeting. We actually had our first meeting this last Monday, I believe, Monday or Tuesday, and we did a review of all the funding formulas, how it was all done, and then in subsequent meetings we will be discussing, you know, the future of maintenance of our roads. Right now we do have, interestingly enough, it's a $59 billion shortfall in state roads, and for cities and counties it's $70 billion shortfall.
Right.
And while, you know, I'm not sure you're right about, we do have the highest tax on gas, we might have the highest gas prices, not quite sure that we have the highest.
No, I said one of the highest.
Okay. But at the same time, we have more road miles, and I'm not defending that, but when you, I went through the process. Frankly, we did a road tax in Napa County when I was supervisor there that passed by the public 73%. And the reason it passed is we said 100% of this money is going to go to roads and streets.
Absolutely,
you know,
right.
It wasn't any Christmas, you know, wish list of 90 things to make everything better for everybody. It was specific to roads and streets. But the power of the dollar, because the amount of gas that's used today because of more fuel-efficient cars since 1990, mm-hmm. because of more hybrids, because of more electric cars and all that entails, and the fact, so on one side, you have the amount of gas you know, going down, and the gas was never, tax was never indexed. So it's kind of like, it was kind of like flat and going, you know, down over time. At the same time, the cost of asphalt is a petroleum-based product. Trucking is involved and labor is involved, and we all know what's happened to labor, trucking, and oil-based products over the last, you know, 25 years. So it's really been a, you know, a collision course, and the problem, if this was just $120 billion local and state issue, and we knew that we could do absolutely, you know, nothing about it, and at the end of 10 years, that would be the amount that would still be owed, that might be something we could ignore for a while we let things calm down, you know, in our communities and in our state, let the economy come back, you know, because I certainly understand that while the economy's come back in the Bay Area and down in select places on the coast in Southern California, it has not come back in the interior communities of the state of counties in the interior of the state of California, and that is mainly where my, you know, what I represent is small rural communities, and it right. has not come back. And we need to find ways of doing things that meld into both economies, the ones that are flourishing but and the ones that aren't. But if we don't do something about this $120 billion problem, it goes up, not doing anything over 10 years. It could more than double.
Right.
And then where are we? So we really need to study these issues and come up with a range of solutions that we can go back into our communities and discuss with our respective constituents.
Okay, well, let me ask you a question on that. Sure. And I'm going to speak specifically for my knowledge or lack thereof here locally. And, for example, the city of Clear Lake when they go through the budgetary process, it's been very obvious that of the $600,000 they get allocated to them from the gas tax, about 70% of that is used for administration purposes, not for road improvement. And I've been told that many, many cities do the same thing throughout California. So my question is, can't maybe the statute be adjusted by at the state level to ensure that the gas tax is actually used the way it's meant to be used instead of being allocated towards admin costs? And that could resolve some of the issues from a funding point of view.
Well, every little bit helps, and so I really appreciate it. I don't know that is true and correct, but...
Well, for Clear Lake, it is.
Yeah, and they're happy to admit it.
If it's true and correct in Clear Lake, I can assure you it's probably true and correct in other places.
Absolutely.
But yeah, I'll be looking into that. I've taken a note here, and you know that's something right away. If they're going to, if cities and counties are going to get state and or federal monies, I think for roads and streets, we need to assure that
it's used correctly.
It is used for road and street money.
Right. Yeah. When I raise that, I'm sorry, honey. When I raised that issue with the council and the finance director who was there at the time, I said, why are you doing this? He said, well, we have some leeway on the definition of the use of gas tax. And they said, well, as long as we're doing, quote, and I'll use my terminology, research and development, or the person we're spending the money on for salaries and benefits is somewhat kind of sort of maybe related to road improvement, that's allowed under the statute.
And they're paying, like, the city engineer salary out of the tax money. They're paying part of the salary for the public works department, et cetera, et cetera. But they're paying entire...
Yeah. My experience over 14 years as a county supervisor is... that was not my experience.
Right.
I'm telling you, it was just... They always held up, whether it's the state or federal government. So let me check on that. Maybe next time we talk, you can bring that back up again, and
okay.
I'll have a more cogent answer for you.
Sounds good. Also,
at the end of the day, what you're saying is exactly correct. That shouldn't be happening. And maybe there's a 3% administration fee or something like that. Like just in any sales tax, it's not even 3%. I think it was in the county of Napa, we just... past that, it was almost $600 million over 30 years.
Wow!
He only allowed 1% for any administration.
Whoa!
Well, that seems pretty common.
Cities and counties to use.
So right.
I'll get on that. We'll talk again.
That's awesome. Now I have to ask you: have you driven through Clear Lake lately?
You're talking now about the town of Clear Lake.
Yes.
The city of Clear Lake.
Yes. Yes.
Yes, I have.
Okay. So you know that they're not putting the money toward the roads. Well, they do when they get state monies, they put it toward the roads, it seems. But that's why the road tax has failed so many times, because people will not support a new tax when they're not utilizing the tax money they're receiving properly to begin with.
Yeah, I have, and it's very unfortunate. Certainly, Clear Lake is not the only community in the state of California. There are lots, particularly on the North Coast, there are just lots of communities that are having similar issues. But if the issues are just as simple as perhaps you have laid your fingers on, we may be running a bill next year to correct that problem. But let me look into that.
I appreciate that.
Yeah, now, thank
part
you.
Part of the on the other side of that equation, and being somewhat familiar with accounting and finances, they say that without using the gas money for admin purposes, that they would cease to exist, because
right.
There's no other, quote, revenue flow coming in to pay for their exorbitant salaries and pensions.
Which they are exorbitant.
I don't think it's up to state road money to be taking care of any of their overhead. Again, I appreciate you bringing that forward.
Right.
We're going to check on some of these things and we get back. One thing I do want to bring up, though, is the condition of your state highways throughout Lake County.
Sure.
I've been totally amazed. 53 and 29, 20, you come down down into Napa or you go over to Yolo County and you drive the state highways, they're nowhere near as good a condition.
Yeah, they're doing a good job with that on the state.
I don't know why that is, but I'm happy for you guys.
So are we. There's one little part in Kelseyville that's a little dicey, but other than that, they're doing a great job. We appreciate that. I know that Jim Comstock had a lot to do with the 29 portion in his district. And so, you know, I think that some of the supervisors are pressuring the state to get these roads fixed.
Well, that's good. And yeah. I think there is some road work going. I was just up there
not
past weekend, but the weekend before. I saw some road work going on in Kelseyville.
Yeah, they're just starting on it again. Now, one more thing to remember when you're looking into the Clear Lake situation. When the city was incorporated, they were handed a couple of areas that are strictly basically dirt roads and very bad condition asphalt roads that were part of the county. And I believe that a lot of these are considered private roads, and therefore there is no mandate to pave them or anything else. So basically the city of Clear Lake is always going to have bad roads until they figure out how to deal with those roads that were passed from the county to the city that basically have no ownership at this point.
Well, you know what? That's a local control issue, which, you know, I've talked to you about local control before. I'm a big believer in that, solving those type of problems locally instead of the state coming in and determining it. One thing I will tell you, if they are, I think you mentioned the number, $600,000 in road tax money that they're getting.
Mm-hmm.
Was it $400,000 or $600,000? I can't remember.
No, it was about $600,000. You know, obviously it fluctuates each year, but it's around $600,000.
My guess is that they probably have double that in need. If they're like any other city.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, absolutely.
In California. But I see what you're saying is, you know, until they use that money appropriately or the rules are followed or whatever's determined, nobody wants to, you know, to bring up, you know, more money. But this, everyone needs to really, though, understand there is a price to be paid for that, and ultimately the taxpayers, one way or the other, because
right,
whether it's general fund, whether it's new taxes or anything, let's face it, it's all of us that are paying the bill, right?
Exactly, exactly. And they're telling these people with the dirt roads they're never going to get fixed. Unless they pay for them to get fixed themselves.
There's a number of communities. I was talking to Senator McGuire about that a couple weeks ago, and he, you know, his district runs all the way up to the Oregon border.
Mm. Yes.
But there's a number of communities that have that same issue.
Yeah, yes. And I'm not trying to pick on Clear Lake. It's just I'm just familiar with their process.
But maybe there's a pathway by taking what's worked in another community.
Yes.
There you go.
Applying that solution to Clear Lake. So that,
right.
I think that's something we can research and maybe be of help.
That'd be awesome.
You know, and honestly, and I think you'll agree with, is that a lot of the smaller cities in the state really are not what I call professional politicians. They're local business people or local citizens who are trying to do service to their city, and they may not have the knowledge or the expertise to understand their potentially.
About this job.
Okay, before you say that, let me let our viewers know.
Increments starting tomorrow.
Oh, wow. So we are back online now.
And,
so
no, it's a full calendar, but I've really managed to make it up there. I think I've been up there three or four times in the last 2 months.
Fantastic.
That's cool.
Session in, you know, and it'll probably be more when, you know, the session is out, but with session in, that's pretty good. But I've been to some really cool, you know, nonprofit events. I think the only thing in closing, what I'd like to do is just reiterate, we're going to be opening that office. Senator McGuire and I will want to see as many people up there, and look forward to your feed on the on live feed on the radio.
Yes.
And then just finally to give, I know I can speak for the senator on this, that it's just a real privilege and honor to be able to represent Lake County, and we learned all about your issues and everything during the campaign. We made some commitments. I think you mentioned we've followed through on them, but you know, I think our hearts are and minds are with you and the needs that you have up there. And I've got great staff here, as does Senator McGuire. So if people need assistance, you know, on anything that they, you know, should be getting from the state that they don't get, or any problems they're having. You know, we've got people in our offices in the district that stand ready to work with them, and my district staff here in Sacramento, as is Mike's, stand to work with the county and its cities on these legislative efforts and efforts with the governor to get more money for Clear Lake.
Cool.
Really appreciate that.
Well, I want to personally thank you for your time that you provide us. You know, you seem to be a regular guest on our show these days, so I just appreciate your time and communicating with us and the county.
It's refreshing and enjoyable. Thank you so much, Mr. Dodd. And we will look forward to visiting with you next time.
Okay, great. Terrific. Looking forward to that as well.
Thanks All right,
a
go
lot.
Back to your busy day.
Have a great day.
Oh, bye-bye. Bye-bye.
All right, that was wonderful. Assemblyman Bill Dodd, and always bringing good news to Lake County and always sharing, you know, He's an action man. That's what I like about
action
him.
Action man.
You tell him something, he's on it.
Yeah.
And I really appreciate
but
that.
He actually listens.
Yes, he does.
He does take notes. We know that from experience because he'll look at us and say, oh, yeah, I did follow up on that issue, and here's what's going down.
Exactly.
So,
oh, no, he's a good man.
Yeah, he is.
We're very blessed to have him. And
he's actually earning his paycheck.
He is.
Which is nice for a change.
For once, we have a politician, you know, we can be happy about. And I say that about Jim Steele, too, but... And Bruno Sabatier. I mean, there are good politicians out there, but they, you know, they're few and far between, unfortunately.
Oh, Bruno's still around?
I guess. I don't know.
I don't know. You know,
maybe.
Bruno's been absent in action.
He's so busy. Oh, he's doing, oh, that's right, Power to the Youth, August 1st.
Okay. Well, he missed a great planning commission meeting at Clear Lake the other day.
Well, why don't we take a quick
I know you
break,
go ahead.
And then we can talk about all that.
We already talked about it.
Okay.
I'm just giving Bruno a hard time.
Bruno, you heard him.
Love you, Bruno. Figuratively.
We'll be back. This is Terry.
And Pete, the tax guy.
And where you are on Lake County Magazine Talk Show. We'll be back
we'll
in
be
Flash.
Back.
Fly like an eagle, let my spirit carry.
Yeah, time keeps on slipping into the future. Fly like an eagle. That goes out to our assemblyman, Bill Dodd. You've been flying like an eagle out here in California since you took over that position, and we're very grateful for the work that you do. Thanks so much. It's kind of weird saying that to a politician. And Pete must have stepped away because his seat is empty, but I'm sure he'll be right back. And yes, here he comes, running. So I hope y'all are having as good a day as we are today, folks. We have the new commander from CHP coming in and joining us at 11 o'clock. And we're very excited. Lieutenant Paredes. We'll have to ask him how to say it properly. I'm not really good at inflections and other languages, so I will definitely be asking for the pronunciation on that one. But he is definitely going to be an interesting talk. I'm really looking forward to that.
Yes.
Yes.
And I hope you enjoyed the tantalizing. No. Anyway, the great conversation Bill Dodd had with us.
He's always a good conversation.
He's
attentive, and that's what's good. He listens. He's hearing what you have to say. And he's there for you.
Absolutely. Like
him. Very interesting.
Who's that?
Yeah, we do. It's a joint statement with Deputy Attorney General Sally Quillen Yates before the Senate Judiciary Committee with James B. Comey, the director of the FBI. And they're talking about going dark. Very interesting.
Okay.
And privacy.
That's interesting. Folks, we have a
I'll
breaking.
I'll probably have it in the next news at 1 Wednesday.
Cool. Okay. We have a little late breaking news, which
what?
May or may not affect. The New York Stock Exchange has been shut down or suspended trading.
Oh my.
They've had some technical difficulties that they will not.
A.K.A. they've been hacked?
Yeah, basically, I
oh
think.
Oh, my gosh.
Well, we don't know that for a fact, but they are shut down or suspended trading right now. So if you have invested in the stocks and you're doing any type of trading on a daily basis, it ain't going to happen today. So as we get further information on that, we'll let you know.
I'm not sure how many day traders we have in Lake County, but
There's a lot of retired people who invest their stocks with some of the major firms. So if you want, we're going to buy or sell something today. It's not going to happen for a while. So that's a little tidbit of information.
Wow, that's kind of weird. And you know, with the Greece thing, there have been.
Yes.
Some interesting things.
Yeah,
going
we've been talking about
the financial
Greece
situation.
On our news show. They are they've missed two deadlines now on the payment of their debt, and their creditors are running out of patience. And the president of the European Union and other things are trying to negotiate with the president of Greece, and he is not cooperating. And they actually had a general election last week, and the citizens said, hell no, we're not going to succumb to the demands of our creditors, and we don't care what happens because we refuse to get any more tax increases, refuse to have our other standard of living interrupted because of these creditors. So it's a really tedious what's the word I'm looking for? Sorry, folks, I don't speak English sometimes. It's a very point of their history where if Greece goes bankrupt, it has a significant...
It's a pivotal point.
Right, thank you. It's a very significant impact on not just Europe, but also on the United States through our investment opportunities.
Right.
And then Puerto Rico is going through the same thing right now. The only difference is Puerto Rico is a territory, not a state. Therefore, they're not allowed to go through the same process that cities and states do in the United States, which means they can't file bankruptcy. They're not allowed to based on law. So that's going to be another very interesting conversation because if they can't file bankruptcy, then they're going to have to renegotiate their debt structure, and a lot of it is with unions on their pension plans. And the unions obviously are going to totally disagree with that. So, and as I mentioned sometime, I think on our news show, that Puerto Rican unions are extremely strong and very protective of their.
But the governors basically said,
screw you.
I'm not going to pay my bills, so
yeah,
what?
Exactly.
I can't pay them? Tough.
Right.
And that's pretty much what the president of Greece has also said.
Right.
So what happens if every government around the world takes that attitude that they're not going to pay their debts?
The world's economy.
Do we just scratch everybody out and start over?
The world economy would just be a disaster. condolences. Well, no, I won't get into that because I don't want to. By the way, folks, besides the New York Stock Exchange, United Airlines and Wall Street Journal website, WSJ.com, are all been hit with computer issues.
Oh, my gosh. Then they've been, there's hacking going on.
The Chinese are
at
it again.
This has to be coordinated.
And that's a personal comment, folks, not
yeah.
a fact.
These have to be coordinated. I mean, why would that all of a sudden be happening?
Yeah, it's
that is definitely breaking news.
And President Obama has been briefed on the situation. The technical problems came as China's stock market continued to sell off Wednesday, losing more than $3 trillion in market value.
Oh, my goodness.
The China market situation sent the Dow Jones Industrial Average down more than 200 points when the computer glitch kicked in. Okay, folks.
Wow.
Here's my
conspiracy theory
is that because the stock market was so impacted by China's sell-off and market value decreasing, they suspended trading so we would not have a significant financial impact in this country.
Well, that could be, but that doesn't explain the Wall Street Journal's website and the other websites that are having problems right now.
I agreed. But
there's something fishy.
It's something fishy here, folks, and we will smell it out.
I think we're heading into a world crisis, possibly.
Well, it's feasible because right now the amount of debt we have with China is absolutely asinine.
We need to put that in our lead story.
We can do a quick overview of that, yes. So hopefully we'll have more information when we hit our 12 o'clock news show, News at Noon, LCM-TV.
Not your normal news.
We're not, no. Nor are the anchors and producers very normal either. So we'll go from there. So it's kind of interesting. Again,
it's not just kind of. It's kind of scary, if you ask me.
Well,
I mean, this could be the end of our financial world as we know it, yeah.
I wish I could sing, because I'd love to.
It's the end of
the world as we know it. Anyway.
You could sing.
We got about a half an hour
before
the commander comes on. Mm-hmm. That will definitely be an interesting conversation.
If you have any thoughts or comments on all this, please feel free to give us a call.
Or Facebook, My Beautiful Wife.
Yes.
Which seems to be the norm these days.
I know. People are shy.
You know, I feel left out. No one ever
and
faces
it. It's such a small town. Everybody recognizes everybody's voice.
That's very true. That's very true. We did that when we were on KPFC. Oh, hi there. How you doing, dude? Yeah. And I'd always ask you, who was that? I recognize the voice. Who was that?
All right.
Yeah. So other than that, we had some follow-up stories that are kind of old news to a certain extent. Is our favorite IRS representative, Ms. Lerner, who resigned after her input on the Tea Party and other nonprofits associated with the Tea Party. It's been revealed recently through investigative tactics that the magnetic tapes that were used to back up all of the emails and correspondence.
How old are those computers? If they're using magnetic
tapes. I know,
tapes,
trust me, I understand.
That is so antiquated.
Totally erased and demagnetized so they couldn't be recovered.
Degaussed.
Degaussed, thank
yes.
you.
Yeah. I used to use a degausser.
Did you?
Yeah, when I
that
worked
sounds,
in radio in Florida.
That sounds kinky.
No, it wasn't. It's this big, huge thing. It has a handle on the top of it. It weighs about 2 pounds.
Right.
And you put it over any kind of audio tape and do that.
Right.
And it goes brrr, just like that, and it erases the tape.
Thank you for the sound effects.
Yes.
It
was fun.
And what happened was that occurred after the congressional committee overseeing this.
Asked for
all of the information. And during their investigation, they said no employee of the IRS purposely did that.
Oh,
there was
whatever.
Just a lack of communication.
Oh, whatever.
And what happened was there were multiple emails that were pertinent to the investigation that were not available to Congress. And so
absolutely.
There's some little bit of...
There's some bad
here's,
things. They got some splaining to do.
Right. And here's my point, being having to deal with the IRS on a regular basis is, and this is what one of the commentaries was, is that it's amazing how the IRS can get away with, oh, I'm sorry, I lost that. Oh,
right.
No, I don't have that available. Oh, well.
If that was a taxpayer?
Yeah, having been through audits with clients and myself, it's like, oh, do you have that receipt? No, but I have a credit card. Nope, sorry, not allowed. Well, do you have this? Well, yeah, I do, but I don't have the actual receipt. Nope, sorry, disallowed. So why does the IRS not practice what they preach?
Because they're the IRS.
Exactly. So hopefully from this situation, Congress will maybe put more of a harder approach to the IRS and have a better oversight committee.
Well, that's it. You know, and with the experiences we had in Phoenix with that overzealous IRS agent who was then labeled rogue by the agency.
Right.
You know, we know how easy it is for them to get out of control.
Yeah, and to kind of explain that comment, folks, is that I appealed the revenue agent's analysis of my tax return.
Our tax return.
And I appealed it to the tax court, which automatically hands it down to a local appeals agent. And after I brought in about 15 boxes of documentation, he kind of looked at me and said,
"Well, we keep everything."
Yeah, way too much. He looked at me and said, "Well, thank you for the records. Obviously, this may take a while to go through." I'm like, "Eh, take your time. I don't care." And then he looked at me and I said, "Can I say this off the record?" And he said, "Sure, that's no problem. I'm an appeals agent. I'm supposed to be impartial. So if you want something to say, say it." I said, "Sir, if I owed over $1 million in taxes, that means that I earned $3 to $5 million. Would you agree with that assumption?" He said, "Yeah." Said, "And if I really did earn that amount of money, do you think I'd be standing here in front of you and not being on a beautiful, sunny, white beach somewhere in the Caribbean?" And he looked at me and just started laughing. He said, "Yeah, that was my attitude too."
Oh, God.
So, and after the audit was completed, they brought in another revenue agent whose name was Hawking.
Oh, that's right.
Yes. They did the audit. Honestly, I don't think they really did. I think they saw all the documentation and said, "I ain't going to mess with this.
Exactly.
It's way too much work." Anyway, so I met with the auditor, the appeals officer afterwards and said, "Well, would you agree to just sign off that your tax return is no change?" And I said, "Of course I will." And he said, "No problem." And then he looked at me and said, "Well, can I tell you something off the record?" And I'm like, "Sure." He said, "Well, we've had experiences with this specific revenue agent in the past, and that's one of the reasons why we kind of decided to forego a complete audit. One, because of all the documentation, but number two, we know how he's acted in the past, and we felt that this audit was somewhat biased."
Oh, you think?
And then I said, "Sure." So he said, "Well, we'll call you when you need to come in, sign off the paperwork." Came back like a week later, and of course I had to deal with the IRS attorney. And he looked at me and says, "Okay, you understand the results of the audit?" "Of course I do." He said, "You agree to there's a no change?" I'm like, "Yeah." And I said, "Well, if you're agreeing to a no change, does that mean you owe me money?" And he said, "Just sign the documents, please." And he was a good guy. I mean, he was being very fair and somewhat of a sensei.
It was really a trip.
Yeah, I said, "Okay, I'll sign. Where do you want me to sign?" I said, "Now, I'm not going to take the time to read every single word in this thing, but you're telling me that this is no change. I'm off the hook. You agree that the IRS revenue agent was wrong and that I'm right." He said, "Well, we're just going to agree that there's no tax liability and we don't owe you a refund." And I'm like, "Whatever." I signed off the documents.
Hey,
that was the end of that.
I'm not arguing.
No, but you know, it just shows you that the IRS does abuse their powers, which not a brand new thought process.
We had tax court going back to 1998. I mean, it was ridiculous. And in all the cases that we went to court, we won against them.
So. And again, I've never lost an audit with a client either.
You know, it's silly. It was just a personal problem this gentleman had.
He hated me.
In the bottom line, it did end up in resulting in Peter going away for a couple of years based on false accusations.
Right. Well, it's funny is
made
that
by him.
Prior to I had another client audited. He was a insurance / securities licensed individual, and I had another revenue agent audit that, and I had the exact same communications with this gentleman, except he communicated back, and he was actually the president of the Corvette Club in the
East,
in the East Valley. And he was a retired chemical engineer who decided to work for the IRS as customer service. And I guess he did such a good job, he kept on getting promoted and finally ended up as a revenue agent. And he admitted to me off the record, like, "You know, I really didn't want this job. I'm not an accountant. I'm not a financial dude. But, you know, they put me through training, so now I'm an auditor." And he went through this clients of mine very calmly. And he asked some questions, and he said, well, can you substantiate this deduction? I said, well, we have receipts, and then if you look at code section, blah, 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 you'll find out that this deduction is authorized. And he said, I'm not familiar with that. Can I get back to you on that?
Wow.
Let me talk to my boss. And he – what line?
9-1.
Oh. Anyway, so voicemail can grab it. Anyway, so he got back to me like 2 weeks later and said, you know, my boss is not familiar with that section. I'm like, well, I showed it to you in black and white. I had the regs right there in front of me. He said, no, I saw what you showed me, but I'm not familiar with it. My boss isn't familiar with it. And he said to disallow it. I'm
what?
Like, well, you're going to have an argument. He said, no, well, I went one step further because I read it. I may not have interpreted it correctly, but I read it. So he went to what they call technical support, which really interprets the codes. And he came back and said, well, you know, they can't prove you wrong, so therefore I'm going to allow the deduction.
This is why the IRS doesn't like him.
So basically what they're saying
or
is –
at least that one agent.
Yeah,
anyway.
What they're saying was, I'm right, they're wrong. But the way they had to word it was made them say like, well – we'll give you this one, even though, you know. And this revenue agent was kind of cool. He was really polite, considerate, and said, look, show me receipts. I'm not going to harp on anything. I'm not enough money here to worry about, but I got to do my job. So every time I challenged him in a polite way, saying, I believe you're incorrect, he went back, did his job, came back, and said, okay, you're cool. No worries. So, you know, there are different personalities involved.
Yeah.
But overall,
and we're grateful for those people that do their job honestly.
Right.
You know, and not with a personal attitude out to get someone.
Yeah. I just got another little press release here on the Chinese markets. Let me put my glasses
this
on.
I'm telling you, we're headed into a crisis here.
Yeah.
This is not good.
Let me just see if I can find it quickly.
This could be very detrimental to our entire world.
Right. The Chinese markets continued their slump on Wednesday, with the main Shanghai index falling more than 8% in early trading. It closed 5.9% lower. Nearly half the listing on China's exchange stopped trading.
Oh my God!
In Wednesday morning, mostly at the request of companies, and some of those listings were actually suspended by regulators. That is scary.
That is scary.
Remember, China owns a lot of our debt.
A lot of our real estate too.
That too, right?
And they could call that debt in at any moment.
Here's a quote. President Xi Jinping, if I pronounce it correctly, is facing a searing test of his commitment to overhaul the country's financial system and open up the state-controlled economy. For a government that loves absolute control, getting pushed around by the market is an unsettling experience. Government may want to maintain control if the stock market weakness continues. So I think there's a political battle going on between the old-fashioned Communist Party
and
what the current president is trying to do through Hong Kong and its financial areas like the stock market. And the other comment here is Beijing moved quickly to try to prop up share prices, with the latest measures coming on Wednesday morning. China Securities Finance Corporation would provide more financing for purchases of shares in small and medium-sized companies. So what's happening here is that the Chinese government is using its own funds to buy stocks at a higher value than they're worth in order to keep the stability of the market there.
That's a dangerous game.
Very dangerous, because when they try to liquidate, mm-hmm. if the market
they're
does come back,
come
they're
going
to lose their blankety-blank.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, it's almost comparable to what the United States government did when Chrysler was going bankrupt and when New York City was going bankrupt, which for you youngsters, you probably don't remember that. For you old farts like me, you probably remember that very clearly, is that the American government came into New York City and had to rescue it, because the last thing this country needed was a big city like New York going under. And then when Lee Iacocca, is that right?
Iacocca,
thank you. My memory sucks.
It's okay.
Came president of Chrysler. He basically said, we're going broke. And the American government came in and said, nah, we'll take care of you. So it just like the government rescued General Motors.
Right, exactly.
In that case, I think the American public actually got a return on their investment. So,
yeah.
So that's what's happening. Unfortunately, this is a worldwide effect, not just a local impact.
And China's fingers are everywhere around the world.
Yes.
They have invested. They have built. They have loaned. They have money out everywhere.
Yeah. So it's not a good thing, folks. And
no,
I know
scary.
A lot of you think this is kind of a boring subject. But, and it may be, but
our
the problem is...
Our world economy is at stake right now.
Yeah, between Puerto Rico, Greece,
now China,
the stock exchange going down. Yeah, something's fishy here in Denmark.
Yeah, we're in a dangerous space right
yeah,
now.
So, anyway, on that note, what other late breaking stories do we have?
Well, I do want to repeat the story about the murderer that was caught in Clear Lake.
Please do.
Breaking news. A murder that occurred on July 2nd over on 35th Avenue. There was a report of shots fired. Officers arriving on the scene located an individual who had suffered unknown injuries. He was treated at the scene and then transported to St. Helena, where he did pass away. And the victim was subsequently identified as 40-year-old Clear Lake resident Stephen T-Bone Galvin. Why are you laughing?
No, I didn't mean to laugh that way. I laughed because his
nickname is T-Bone.
No, I know.
On yesterday, July 7th, Clear Lake detectives received information linking a person of interest to this case in the homicide. And based on this information, they have charged 35-year-old Clear Lake resident Billy Mount, who actually was previously arrested for outstanding warrants on July 5th, and he is now being held in Lake County Jail on a charge of murder in this case and other related charges. So during the investigation, it was learned that there are other possible witnesses to this homicide. Those persons are encouraged to come forward with whatever information they might have to assist this matter, as well as the fact that Clear Lake Police Department also wishes to thank the men and women of Station 70 of Lakeshore Fire Station in the search of a difficult crime scene. And anyone with information relating to this case is encouraged to contact Detective Ryan Peterson at the Clear Lake PD at 994-8251, extension 30. Also, I do want to let people know there is a 15-year-old girl that's been missing from her home from the 26th of June. She was last seen on the 26th of June by her stepdad at 12:30 in the morning in her Hidden Valley Lake home. Her name is Faith Elizabeth Ross. You do have a picture on your stick, Mark, if you want to try to pull it up.
All right.
When her mom and stepdad woke up at 6:30 a.m., she was gone, and there was a note left behind with what I consider typical teenage complaints about not being understood, not listening to her, etc. But there were some other personal comments that aren't being disclosed. She said she would be in touch through Grandma Dawn, who's a neighbor, and promised to call at some point to let them know she's okay. Well, she hasn't called. She hasn't accessed her Facebook page, and that's very unusual for her. And she told Don that she was going to a grow house down a dirt road in Clear Lake. However, she was spotted in the Oaks at the Red and White store with several other girls and could be working as a trimmer. If you have any information on the whereabouts of Faith, please call her mom at 809-7081. She's very worried, and she really needs her to come home.
Absolutely.
15 is too young to be on the streets, man. Even if you're staying with people that you know and trust, you still need to be in your home.
You need to be at home.
Yeah.
Since we have the commander coming on at 11-ish.
Yes, dear.
I'd like to bring up the event that occurred down on Pier 14. Of the shooting of
yes,
the young
the
lady.
Yes, the shooting, yes.
And, you know, the shooting itself
this
was...
This is a really serious
yeah,
story. And unfortunately, Donald Trump is running with it now as
oh,
justification for his comments he made about illegal immigrants, because
yeah,
this guy was an
yeah,
illegal.
The shooting was tragic enough as it is, and I don't want to harp on that because I think most people are probably aware of that. What really kind of bothers me is that the gentleman who allegedly did the shooting, he stated that he picked up the gun, was starting to shoot at the sea lions, which to me is just ridiculous anyway. And,
yeah,
and the gun went off three times, pop, pop, pop. And that's when he realized that this young lady was shot and obviously passed on.
Catherine Steinle, she was 32 years
thank
old,
you,
unfortunately.
My point here that I try to communicate, which is difficult for me sometimes, is that this Hispanic gentleman had been deported, I believe, five times.
Five times.
Had been arrested. And then released.
For violent crimes,
right,
too.
But he was released by the San Francisco Police Department because their attitude is, unless there's a warrant out for his arrest.
It was a 10-year-old marijuana possession case.
Right, but.
To them, it wasn't worth pursuing because right. when he was charged, it was when marijuana was illegal.
Right, but the point here is that instead of contacting immigration to pick up this gentleman.
They let him go before ICE
could
get him.
They just let him go because they don't bother worrying about, well, if it's just illegal immigration, yeah. we don't care about it.
Yeah, and that's so wrong. I mean, there has to be a detention facility. These people need to be held until someone can come and get them and take them back home.
Right. Well, in
because they don't belong here.
Back in Arizona, there was.
I'm not trying to be racist or anything.
No, it has nothing to do with racism.
Plenty of great people, but people like that who has a record and a criminal
right.
history. They don't belong here in America.
Right. And figures Trump would pick up on that.
Of course. It was a perfect opening for him.
Of course it was.
Yes.
Yeah, so,
he's like, see, I told you so.
Yeah. But and then there was another case, and I can't remember the situation, that someone got released from state prison in California after serving, I think it was 2 years, on a murder charge. Can you please explain to me how the state prison parole board would allow a convicted murderer to be released from prison on parole after only serving a very minimal amount of time on his sentence? That does not make sense.
Well, it depends on the kind of murder charge. If it was involuntary manslaughter, then he could have been released in a couple of years because that has a much lesser sentence.
Well,
depends on what he actually did in the way of murder, too.
Well, we discussed this at home, and I told you that a gentleman I know in Arizona was involuntary manslaughter, not murder, but manslaughter, of a pedestrian who walked
but
right
that
in
was
front
like
of his,
a DUI or something,
yeah, walked
right?
in front of his car, in between cars, wasn't at a crosswalk, and the gentleman I know was a bartender, and he just shut down from a casino. And he had one too many drinks, but he was in control of his vehicle. He wasn't speeding. He wasn't swerving. But because he passed the DUI limit in his breath test, whatever it's called, he was charged and convicted of involuntary manslaughter, even though the pedestrian he hit was drunker than a skunk, and he was. It was still this gentleman's fault. And he served, was sentenced to 8 years in prison and got out after 6.5. So he'd served his time. Hopefully he's learned his lesson, which I believe he has. But
what is the lesson? Watch out for people walking between cars when you've had a couple of drinks?
Yeah, basically. I mean, I could see him being guilty of a DUI. But when the pedestrian is running out between parked cars on a busy street, drunk or in a skunk, there has to be a reasonable sentencing on there. But these people being released from prison, and I realize there's some nonviolent people being released for pot charges or just non-violent, non-victimized type crimes is fine. But I don't care what type of murder, voluntary, involuntary, manslaughter, involuntary manslaughter, serving just a couple years out of a sentence doesn't seem to teach anyone a lesson.
Mm-mm.
That's my viewpoint. And this is coming from someone who
unfortunately has... Well, and again, it still depends on the situation. Let's take, for example, this guy that they caught the other day. Let me pull up the story on him because... That's pretty absurd, too, the fact that he was actually still out after a, voluntary manslaughter charge. Let me jump here.
And, folks, a lot of these stories are are addressed on our News at Noon show Monday, Wednesdays, and Fridays.
Right.
That was a plug.
It's not your normal news.
That's right.
So, and this article was written by our own Megan Berger. And Megan has really stepped up in Lake County Magazine and is doing a really good job just getting stories into the magazine that are of interest to many people. Oh, what's wrong with this thing? And we appreciate the efforts that she's making. She's not a professional. Most of us are not,
not professionals.
Professional. We're doing this because we love our community and we would like the community to be able to get information as much as possible.
In a non-biased manner as much as we can.
Right.
I do have my...
I know there was a lot of controversy with her story about with the guy that has the lawsuit against
yeah,
the city.
Yeah, but it was reporting what the facts were based on the interview.
Why isn't this working?
I don't know. I know how you are with electronics.
Stop it.
Okay. So while she's gathering that information...
It's waiting.
Okay. There was a story that we're going to be commenting on or reporting on at noon today. There was an FBI undercover agent that basically...
No, he was DEA, dear.
I thought you said FBI.
DEA.
I apologize,
folks. It was
the
FBI report on...
Oh, my bad. DEA agent that was undercover, and I guess he got too comfortable in being undercover, and he started...
No, I think he was a DEA doing an investigation. I don't even know if he's undercover.
Yeah, yeah, he was undercover.
Okay.
Yeah.
Anyway, he was definitely a bad boy.
He was basically committing money laundering. He was taken through false identities. He was getting paid in bitcoins, that was called? Bitcoins, which is like an internet currency. He was benefiting in other manners and... selling drugs and stuff like that instead of arresting people. And so, you know, no one's perfect, folks. Everyone out there, be it law enforcement
or
otherwise.
Not only that, but he made a deal with Fox Studios to do his actual movie.
Oh, really?
About the event. And he received a $250,000 at cash advance without even telling his bosses that he was going to do the movie.
Well, I know the IRS is now investing him from their criminal
investigations division.
So,
I love it.
You know, I'd rather be investigated
it's
by the CIA than the IRS.
Yeah, than the CI division.
Yeah, that's they're not nice people.
No. Okay, so I did find the story about what happened on Friday. Calls went over the scanner for medical aid on a subject due to canine deployment by the Clear Lake Police Department. And the subject was 24-year-old Eric McPherson, also known to some as the Harbor Light Killer. He killed a man at the Harbor Light Motel in Clear Lake back in 2008, not that far back. He was only 18 at the time. He was arrested and charged with the stabbing death of a 40-year-old man and convicted in April 2009 for voluntary manslaughter and was on parole for that when he was arrested again Friday. And he was on parole for murder, and he was living in Clear Lake. And the warrants that he got were not for homicide that were out for him. That was just, he had been on parole for this actual murder of this man at the Harbor Light Motel in Clear Lake. So he is now in jail. They arrested him because he was kind of lurking through someone's backyard. And a woman came out to let her dogs in and found this man in her yard. And he kind of put his finger up to her and said, shh, you know, in a kind of somewhat scary manner, you know. And went over her fence into another neighbor's yard, and she called 911. And when they came, they found him hiding in the neighbor's yard. The canine dog got him, and they bit him and, you know, put him in jail again.
Poor puppies.
So he violated his parole, and he had possession of a controlled substance.
Shame on him.
Resisting arrest, and he had an outside agency warrant, which was not a murder warrant.
No.
So here he is, just like you're talking about.
Yep.
Somebody who actually willfully killed someone, out on parole after 2009, he went to prison. So how many years?
Six.
Right. So he had voluntary manslaughter charges against him, and he's still out on the streets,
you know,
lurking.
What can I say?
So. You know, I mean, not that lurking is such a crime, but...
Well, depends upon what they're lurking at.
And
on
what they're
note.
Lurking, yeah. Well, it scared this lady, and right. I can understand that fully.
You want to take a quick break? Our guests, I believe, are here.
I have to get something queued up.
Okay, well, I'll ramble for a minute or two so you get something going
here.
Please
ramble, will you?
I'm very good at rambling, folks. So
yes, he is.
Yes, I am. So, anyway, it's interesting how due to the overpopulation of our prison system, and I'm making an assumption here, which I probably shouldn't, that some of these inmates are being released, rightfully so or not. So,
well, overcrowding causes a lot of these problems.
Yeah, overcrowding is not a fun
but
place.
But a murderer or somebody, I don't know, no matter how good they are in prison, you take a look at this guy. He's covered in tats. He definitely is a criminal type. I know you can't, shouldn't
now you're,
be.
Now you're, now you're.
Shouldn't be profiling
thank you.
People.
You can't do
but,
that. But unfortunately, when you see tats and the, some of the tats that me, the, help me, the teardrop, thank you.
Well, I don't know if he has a teardrop or it's just a scar in his face.
No, but when you see a teardrop, you kind of like, hey, dude, what's going on? And you just keep on walking.
Well, you have to wonder about people that put tattoos on their face anyway.
Yeah, well, yeah. Or on the back of their head. Yeah. No comment.
But, I mean, the kid killed someone at 18.
I know.
It's kind of a bad way to start your life off, you know.
Yeah, but you don't know his upbringing. And as I told you, many stories about kids being raised
by
the streets.
It's very sad.
So, anyway.
Okay, so we're
going to
take a quick break. I got some music, and we'll be back with the new commander of CHP.
And don't say in a flash.
No, Flash is on the air conditioning vent at home.
Yes, he is. Cool.
That's our cat. Okay, folks, we'll be back. This is Lake County Magazine with Terry.
And Pete, the tax guy.
See you soon.
And unfortunately, we will be back.
What do you mean, unfortunately? Fortunately.
Find no work, least nothing I will do in this old mid-east town. Pockets are empty and I've got too much pride. Won't see me handing out no Walmart stars. And the food prices keep going up. And the weed I sell on the weekends ain't paying me enough. And I can't grow no garden, the snow covers it up. California, I'm coming home to you. Packed up my sandals, packed up my dungarees. Put all my tie-dyes in a box. Lord, I won't need them and I won't need no shirt. Probably won't even need my socks. Packed up my little car and I'm on my way. Wipers are busted, pray I don't get no rain. Then somewhere outside Elko, my tires, they went flat. California, you ain't holding me back. Here in California, fruit hangs heavy on the vine. And the fields turn brown in the summer. So thank God for the weed, water and wine. Job in the ganja picking fields.
Ooh,
fragrance much sweeter than gold. Got me a sweater and a hoodie made of hemp. The winters do get cold. Yeah, the winters they get rainy and cold. So I sit and watch the waves crash on the rocks. And I live in a small town where no one's doors are locked. And I sit by the wood fire and sing songs with my friends. California, I hope this never ends. Here in California, the fruit hangs heavy on the vine. And the fields turn brown in the summer. So thank God for the weed, water and wine. On the vine, and the fields turn brown in the summer. So thank God for the weed, water, and wine. So thank God for the weed, water, and wine. I thank God for the weed, water, and wine.
Online TV. Okay, and you need to flip your switch on the front of your microphone. And that was Human, and it's called Here in California. The camera that's pointing you is where you're going to talk to your audience. And just to give people know, that was Human and the Human Revolution, and it's called Here in California. And the theme of that song was Thank God for the Weed, Water, and Wine.
Oh, you had to play that one here? Really?
Well, it's a fact of our life, let's face it. And there's no point in glossing it over. It is it's part of our economy. It's part of our our citizenry, and it is part of the issues that face Lake County, including the wine and everything. So here we are. Welcome. So, Lieutenant, explain to us exactly how to pronounce your last name so I don't butcher it.
Paredes.
Paredes.
You want to do it in Spanish?
Paredes. Okay. But, well, I don't do very... I do Spanglish, really.
Okay. But in English,
I'm from Miami, so I have a little Spanglish in me.
I'm sure if you could blend it.
Paredes.
If you could speak a little closer into the mic, please.
And we're going to pass on that. Whoever's calling, if they're calling for the show, you're calling on the wrong phone. So welcome. And we're so happy. And Corey Reynolds, who's the public information officer with CHP. Good morning. Thank you for joining us. I'm sorry we kind of forced you into this.
I didn't know that. It's her fault. I don't take.
Hey, if I got to be here.
I have to do what he tells me.
That's right. It was orders, right?
It's a team.
Exactly. Right.
It is. And, of course, we deal with Corey a lot in all the things that happen on the highways here. Just for everyone's knowledge, if you would mind just starting off giving us some of your background and experience and what brought you to be the commander at CHP in Clear Lake.
Sure, it's a pleasure. Again, we'd like to thank the Lake County Magazine for inviting us down and taking the opportunity to speak with us. It's important for the CHP, the Highway Patrol, but even more importantly for us at the Clear Lake CHP office located in Kelseyville to be able to speak out and hopefully create a partnership with the community where they can not only see us as the officers at patrol, but that we are very approachable and that we're here to really serve them. So more on me, well, I've been on a long time. I don't know how to break that down other than I've been on for just over 32 years and had a lot of experiences. I worked as an officer for many years, for 10 years in the field, and then I started taking on other interests, working in some administrative areas, and then gradually began to promote and worked in East LA as a sergeant.
Oh, wow.
For a little while. And
challenging.
It was different. You know, mm-hmm. It was obviously a very concentrated Hispanic community with their special needs. And that was back in the mid-90s, and after working there, I moved back to the San Diego area where I came from.
Okay.
You know, before
I was born in San Diego.
Okay.
Yep.
I've actually spent most of my career in some capacity down there.
So oh, nice.
Whether as a sergeant or as a lieutenant, as a worked at a scale facility for about 7 years down at the border,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And oversaw our operations down there, had the opportunity of working dealing with NAFTA issues at the time.
Wow, that's interesting.
Then did a little stint in auto theft, again down in the San Diego region.
My cousin was a commander in the San Diego area. His last name is Abels. He just recently retired, I want to say probably about 5 years ago. He retired he went as far as he could go with it. I know his brother's name is Steve. We're not that close, but mm-hmm. When I arrived here in 2009, he was just getting ready to retire. So you may have actually worked closely with him.
Sounds familiar.
Yeah, Abel's. Maybe it was Robert, possibly.
Did he work for the Highway Patrol?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and just recently retired, like 5 years ago.
Because so. I know we have the current division commander in the whole Southern Border Division area that comprise of five counties is Jim Abley.
Oh, no, right, this is Abel's, definitely. So, yeah, but he was in more, I think, northern, like maybe Orange County area, that type district. So, yeah, but I was very surprised because I knew him as a kid and we were separated for many years. I finally went to San Diego and my uncle says, oh, yeah, he works for CHP. And I said, oh, that's cool. Yeah, so. Yeah, I feel like part of the family just because of that.
Okay.
Sounds like we have a certain kind of connection.
Yeah. It's funny, you said you were in the east part of L.A. I have a friend and client that was a L.A. Police O'Neill, Department, right? And he worked with the feds a lot in racketeering charges. And his division was Hollywood.
Yeah, there is a Hollywood division.
But yeah, that's an exciting place to work.
Yeah, he actually had to deal with a lot of the celebrities and had to handle them in a very diplomatic way. And he was very – he resigned because he got tired of having to deal with the elite, for better choice of words. Yeah. But he was a good guy. Very, very, very good gentleman. So
anyway, back to your story.
Yeah, that's all right. So
we do have these sidebar parties every now and then.
But, I again, in the many years I've been involved – been on the highway patrol, this has basically been about the only job I've really had, other than worked at a pizza place before while I was going to school. And but I primarily lived most of my life in San Diego in some capacity, even though I've worked in San Jose when I first promoted to lieutenant, and I've been a lieutenant now, I'm pushing 15 years. So
wow.
And then a commander, I've had three different assignments that have involved command positions. Prior to coming here, I was working at the Communication Center in San Diego, and I was the commander there.
Nice.
So I did that for about 5 years. And you asked what brought me up here. Typically, the Clear Lake CHP office will normally have it'll be a promotional position, someone that's promoting into the area.
Mm-hmm.
The previous commander actually is from the general region, so he actually had a great, I think, connection to the Lake County.
Yes, he came in from Ukiah, I believe, right?
Greg Martz, yeah. Yes. And he actually promoted on and is now a captain in the Santa Rosa area.
Oh, great. So he's still in the area.
Yeah, he still has, I think, a lot of ties and connections to the area. But for me, it was more of an opportunity. I'd never been to Northern California. I'm ashamed to say I'd never been north of Sacramento, and which is where our headquarters is. Did a lot of training. I've spent a lot of time in Sacramento, and I always thought that Northern California compared to Southern California is just a beautiful place.
I have to agree with you on that
one. Now that you've lived here, what do you think?
I think it's stunning.
It is amazing, isn't it?
I don't like the heat.
Well,
coming out of Arizona for 30-odd years, this heat's...
Yeah, but you get it down south, too.
It cools down. Yes, it does.
And at night, it's better.
But we don't... we don't get the extremes.
Yes,
we
true.
We don't get the three digits.
That's true.
In San Diego, a hot day on the coast is maybe 80 degrees.
Right.
Yeah. When you were doing East LA, you might see some days like that.
Yeah, there were some warm days, but I think it just cools down a little bit more at night.
Yeah. Well, typically, it's not this hot. This is the second or third year of this extreme heat. It's not cyclically. I know, Corey, you've been here for a while. Wouldn't you say we've had some pretty mild summers? I mean, this is extreme compared to what
we've
I've
had mild summers
seen.
The last few years. It's nice to see the heat back, I think. I don't know if you've noticed. I was just talking to somebody else about this. The gnat population is down. Mm-hmm.
I did notice that, yeah. Is that what does it, the heat?
We've got swarms of them around us. They're not around, so I'm hoping we're getting back into our normal weather pattern.
That's what it looks like.
Rain this winter.
They're predicting rain for this weekend, actually. Well, Thursday,
I got a ball game. They can't rain.
Well, it should be done by Sunday, but Thursday through Saturday. We'll see. We'll take whatever we can get. I don't care about your ball games.
I do.
He plays baseball, men's senior league baseball
down in Santa Rosa.
So, yeah, it's kind of crazy.
Keeps me kind of sort of young.
Finding a way to stay fit.
55 and over league,
I'm 63, and I've been this way my whole life. I was a long-distance runner in college and high school. I can't gain a pound to save my life.
No, I'm trying to get him to gain weight because he keeps losing it, and it's not good.
So, anyway.
But he loves his sports, so I can't keep him out of it.
It's not my show.
So anyway. Now you're here, and would you say this is comparable to some of the other jobs that you've had in the past, or is it completely different?
No, it's kind of an expected comment by me, but I just came from our training day. We break them up, half the officers one day, and then the following week we usually have the other half, and because of our officers are required to have so much training to meet certain requirements and standards, and I normally there's a commander's hour, so to speak, at the beginning of training day, and what I was just sharing with them again, and I'm always in awe. It's just a beautiful place to work, and yes, Lake County has its own specific issues, and both I think from the public's perception of us, law enforcement, and as well as our ability to serve the public and the specific problems that we have here. right, from law enforcement's perspective, is really affected, you know, by the social issues, by the economy, by the marijuana issue. I mean, it's just,
absolutely,
it all goes hand in hand.
And also, I imagine, by the wine industry with all the wine tastings and drunken drivers. I mean,
you know,
we see.
I don't see, at least in the, I've been here almost a year, and I don't know, maybe Corey can comment on this. We do see there is an economic transition that appears to be going on with the wine industry. But from what I understand, a lot of the wine is being grown and being purchased by Napa.
That's correct.
Mm-hmm. And so,
yeah, a lot of the tasting rooms have closed, but we still do have some that are open, and then they have the wine adventure and all the other events over the year.
We're not seeing a DUI picture, so to speak.
Oh, really?
Related to the wine industry.
Okay.
At least we haven't experienced that, the CHP.
Interesting.
In this area, which is comforting.
Yeah.
I think that's another community I definitely want to approach and mm-hmm. make sure that we have good relationships with, and we can promote responsible drinking and
right.
responsible usage of the roads. And so far, we haven't had that issue.
Interesting.
You know, so we do have an issue with DUI here.
That's why I thought it was possibly related to the wine, but is it more prescription drugs and other issues?
I think it's a combination of many things.
Okay.
And right now, it's a lot of alcohol,
mm-hmm.
and it is a lot of drugs. You know, we do have the DUI drug, marijuana impairment on the road, and that's really, it's an issue for us.
Sure.
And on a more personal level, I can say that this year alone, we've had 13 fatal traffic accidents.
Yeah.
We just did a report on that on our news.
And that's
disheartening. It's so sad. It's just
disheartening. Yeah. You know, I was at one here just a couple of days back where the truck driver lost his life.
Yes, the big rig.
And we don't know, so I'd be really speaking out of turn if we were to say or imply that the driver that caused this accident was impaired. We don't know that.
Is that the blood tests haven't come back yet?
Yeah. So we don't know. We did find some indicators in the car that there's a possibility that could, you know, could have happened. But again, I don't want to.
Is there any possibility he might have been texting or doing something? I know he crossed a double yellow line.
There's always a possibility.
But did it look like, we don't know yet? Okay.
All that's being examined
good.
A bit more closely to find out.
I'd love to, you know, get the results of that, because I think it's really important for us as media to let people know what caused these accidents so that they're aware of what they can do maybe to stop it in their own lives. You know, we all know texting and driving is bad, but a lot of people do it. And the only way to reinforce how bad it is to let people know this guy killed somebody, if that was the reason, you know, not necessarily this case, but in other cases. And, you know, people doing stupid stuff a lot of times just causes these things to happen.
Yeah, what I've seen, excuse me, what I've noticed, especially in the last 3-4 months, driving back and forth to Santa Rosa on Sundays, driving around the community here, is that there seems to be a lot of lack of skills in driving. people passing on double lines, people passing around curves and uphills where you can't have a visible sight of the traffic coming on. It scares the hell out of me.
Right.
You know, and when I first moved back from Australia, when I was living there, I moved to San Diego. I was one of the select few that when I applied for my motorcycle license, I actually had to go through the San Diego Police Motorcycle Training Program. It was an experiment at the time. And I just think there's possibly a lack of proper training. I mean, let's face it, it's simple to get a driver's license. And I just don't know if there's a proper
amount of driver's ed in school. I mean, do they really offer that anymore? I know you have some classes that are offered. For example, the bike rodeo is coming up. We'll talk about that later. But there is no real driver's ed in California that kids are required to take to learn how to drive.
Very, very few schools now offer the driver's ed. One of the programs that the Highway Patrol is affiliated with is called Impact Teen Driver. And I went up for one of their presentations up in Shasta, and the lady basically said that, you know, today a kid can get a license after 6 hours of training.
Phew.
And she asked the question, would you get in a plane with a pilot that had 6 hours of training?
Hell
no.
Of course, no. Nobody would, right? But that's what we're...
Oh, that's Sydney.
By the way, that's Sydney.
She's our house dog.
That's what That's what the...
Yeah, she's going to really say hi to you, Corey.
Oh. All right, Sydney.
She's good. She's just saying hello. She'll leave him alone. Good but girl.
That's really all the that's all you need.
Yeah.
That's 6 hours. Because the other 50 hours that's required of the kids under their permit, 50 hours of driving with a parent, 10 mm-hmm. of it has to be at night. How many parents are doing that?
Right. Right. None.
Because all that
not
requires is
many.
A parent just to sign the form.
I know. It's so There's sad. No and you know, so many today, the youth today, and I feel so old saying this, but the youth today, the parents just don't seem to really care too much what the kids are doing. And it causes, I think, a lot of problems in our society, not just driving.
I think there's a lot of it. Yeah. For instance, I've had two kids that now we've recently, my oldest is 23, my mm-hmm. middle one is 19.
We've raised three ourselves.
The good thing that happened when they started driving was my dad was retired.
Oh, nice. Yeah.
So, you know, I was working the road back then, and I was working graveyards, and, you know, my wife was working all day, and so my dad would go by the house,
cool.
pick up the kids after school, and they'd go driving for however long. Hmm. And so I don't see it as necessarily maybe the parents don't care. Is that,
well, they don't have time.
Well,
they're working, trying to make ends meet.
Right.
You know,
two-income families these days.
Yeah, that's true. It's kind of wrong to say that they don't care. It's just they don't have the time to put into it.
But you have to put in that time.
You do.
Because the other part of that is they die in a traffic accident.
Whose fault is that?
How bad are you going to feel?
Right.
Exactly.
You have to give them something.
Right? Yep, exactly.
So on a more serious note, not
like,
that this
like
is
that's
serious,
not serious.
What are your objectives or what are your concerns in taking over, and what are you trying to accomplish here during your term?
You know, ultimately, the mission of the department is about saving lives, and in having come up here, I've seen what I'm learning, what the needs are, and how we, as from the CHP's perspective, can fill a need for the community in our specific mission of saving lives. So what we've been doing, and I say we, are our officers, the sergeants, and boy, I've been keeping Corey busy doing more Start Smart programs with the teens, just getting out in the community, trying to build better partnerships and relationships with all aspects of the community, whether it's with our law enforcement partners, with the schools, we just had some great training here last month with the Lake County Behavioral Health, trying to address the critical incidents mm-hmm. related to mental health, and getting our officers up to a level of training where we can better serve excuse me, that community as well.
That's awesome. But that's a big, big thing for me, as a matter of fact, because I'm sick and tired of seeing people taking their lives around here. We have the highest rate of suicide almost in the state. And there has to be a way that we can recognize these people and have a safety net for them. And I'm not sure what that is yet, but I plan on really researching it more and finding out what we can do.
Don't we have a guest coming on next week or the week after?
We are, yeah. There's a clinical psychologist right. who's going to come forward, and he's going to bring one of, I think he may be bringing in a future show, he's going to be a regular guest on our show. But he is going to be also bringing someone from mental health in regularly as well. And we're going to start talking about strategies. What can we do to reach out to our community? How does a family member tell when somebody is wanting to make that jump, you know? And it's just, there's so many things that we really need to start paying attention to in our community and our neighbors, you know. Talk to your neighbor, know who your neighbor is, you know. It's just very sad.
Like, and, you know, I want to say, I really give credit to this county. Right now, they're working very diligently. The Lake County Behavioral Health, this class was put on in conjunction with another organization out of Sacramento. And it was for first responder type of individuals. And
oh, fantastic.
I think some of the areas where the problems that we're having, I think statewide, is just the lack of resources.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there was a number that was floated out to us that there used to be 20 years ago approximately 37,000 beds for psychiatric needs. And now statewide, they're down to about 4,000.
Oh, my goodness. See?
Psychiatric needs. So you can understand.
So we're
that,
just, that's that, why we have so many homeless. We're pushing them out on the street because there's nowhere for them to go.
Right. So the need is still there, mm-hmm. and it has spilled over into other social areas, including law enforcement and the jails, you know, so, and emergency rooms. And so that need, I think, is still there. And we in law enforcement are typically trained more to respond to incidents, address the incident, mitigate the incident, and then use whatever tools we have available. And unfortunately, I think we had been missing the boat on providing that additional training
mm-hmm.
in what they're calling CIT training, critical mm-hmm. incident team training related to mental health
mm-hmm.
and looking at it from different perspectives.
Yeah, I guess it starts at dispatch, right? When the person makes that call.
Well, that's one. You know, but
that,
it's the
where do they direct that?
And identifying mm-hmm. from a place of safety, because there's mm-hmm. there's a fine line here when you're dealing with someone that's in a mental crisis that maybe wants to take their own life and may want to take somebody else with
right.
them at the same time. So we have to make sure that our officers are doing this safely for everybody's sake and be able to have that resource. And I can say that from what we learned here last month, that the Lake County Behavioral Health and Stephanie Wilson, I think is the name that comes to mind, they're doing a great job. They've actually acquired some resources and some funding. They're going to be opening some more mental health areas where, if as long as somebody is not deemed what's called a 5150, which is in critical
mm-hmm.
crisis,
right.
where they're going to have to be admitted for a 3-day hold and evaluation.
And that would be in our local hospitals?
Yeah, normally that's
okay.
what's going to happen. But
okay.
if they're not, if they're just having something that's not quite at that level, but they need some help, they need some resources.
There's referrals.
There's going to be a place, in fact, they're going to be opening up a place here soon in Kelseyville that we'll be able to take people to there.
Oh, fantastic.
And they can get some help. So
that'll be excellent.
Back to your original question, what is my vision, so to speak, is that we will continue to address and identify the needs. For example, whether it's with teen drivers, we identified an issue with kids wearing. We're going to talk a little bit about the bike rodeo.
Mm-hmm.
So
helmets,
take away that. But really, kind of the genesis of that is we were seeing that since I've gotten here, we had two boys that lost their lives
mm-hmm.
to bicycle accidents
mm-hmm.
because they weren't wearing helmets. And
mm-hmm.
in Middletown Parade, we had another boy that I learned also had a critical crash and hurt himself and had a serious head injury, again, for not wearing a helmet. And
unfortunately, we're not getting those stories. I would love to,
right.
again, maybe not release the young man's name, but at least release the story of the incident, again, to let parents know how important it is. I remember one story, and I want to say the young man was here from Lower Lake, and he suffered a head injury on his bike. I don't even think he got hit or anything. He just fell over and hit his head because he wasn't wearing a helmet and passed away. So these are things that, again, by bringing him out in the media, we drill this stuff into their heads
sure.
every single time. Get that helmet on your kid. This is what can happen.
Right.
You know, so that's where I think our role as media is to help enlighten the parents and inform them what they can do to keep their kids safe. You know, it's just doesn't seem like we're getting the information when these things happen and,
right.
you know, that we can put it out
right.
there.
Well, we appreciate like this opportunity right now to
mm-hmm.
be able to speak about this issue
mm-hmm.
and let you know that I meet there's a Lake County Chiefs meeting every month,
mm-hmm.
and it's attended by Sheriff Martin, Chief Craig Clausen from Clear Lake,
mm-hmm.
Chief Brad Rasmussen from Lakeport,
mm-hmm.
District Attorney Don Anderson, and others. And everybody has you asked me also how's it different coming up here. What's really been special and different is that my counterparts have a genuine interest in the community.
Mm-hmm.
So the things that we talk about is truthfully from our different perspective with our different resources and how we can make the community safer and how we can address the needs of the community.
Right.
And I can tell you that it's been really rewarding, it's been refreshing and reinvigorating for a guy who's at the tail end of his career to see that there are people that truly want to make a difference. And
this is why we love Lake County,
yeah.
because we feel the people are what makes Lake County as special as it is. Yes, there is a crime element, maybe percentage-wise higher than other communities, but there's also a good people element that the percentage is also higher than other communities. I see our community being very much together. When there's a need, they step up no matter what. And I have to give Chief Clausen and CPD a great round of applause for their recent activities in apprehending murderers and important criminals that have been on the streets in their town, and they have managed to round them up, and we do appreciate that. So I'm not going to let that go unnoticed, you know, and we'll be talking about that on our new show later today. But it's so important to keep on top of these guys, you know. It just takes work.
Yeah, there is good law enforcement leadership here.
Right, yes. On kind of a lighter note, when is we're going to improve the press releases versus
yes,
getting them
Mr.
faxed?
Okay, so my problem, when you guys send me a faxed news release, I have to completely write that news release into my program. If you send it to me as a digital copy, I copy and paste it, I adjust the wording to suit the flow of the story, sure. And it takes 2 minutes as opposed to 30 minutes.
Right, what meaning
to
is
put
that
a story
we
together.
Can actually put that news release out immediately,
right.
Versus, oh my, well, I don't have time, I've got to get this job finished first, then I
yeah,
can go back.
Yeah, I always
and
have
it.
To hold your guys' stuff until the end because I just don't have time to deal with it. Yeah. You know, so do you have any plans to improve that process at all?
Our what we deal with is the technology that we have.
Yeah.
The reason the fax is that's after hours stuff is usually always faxed. If it's the day.
Obviously, it's not a fax scanner.
it is a scanner, but.
Because if you scan it in, then you can email it.
Right. And they, see, that's where they have to wait for me to get there.
But that's something we can definitely look at.
I would love that. It would make our life so much easier.
We can get that information out.
Because we miss a lot of stories just because of the time, you know, we can't put them in.
Right.
You know.
Normally, it takes a little time to make sure that we get all the facts. Mm-hmm. And sometimes mm-hmm. it takes several hours before we really get an
Certainly.
Idea of what happened. And then, of course, there's privacy issues that we always have to guard.
Always, yeah. Yeah.
But I think that's something that that we can remedy.
We'd love
but
that.
I can always email it to you if it's if it happens at night and I work 6 days.
Yeah, because we don't work overnight anyway, so we wouldn't receive anything till 10:30 in the morning anyhow. So if you could do that,
you
that would be
you
lovely.
Email me, I'll send it right to you.
Cool,
that'd be
Thank
very
you.
Helpful.
Now, a couple of cases I wanted to get a little follow up on. The two young men that crashed and burned, I think in Lower Lake here not too long ago. Has there been any determination? I'm sure the identity hasn't come back in yet because there was issues on that. But also, what maybe if that was impaired driving or anything and causing it? Do we have any tests back yet?
That's a bit of a what's turning out to be a bit of a more complex
really
investigation as well because of the you know what ended up unfortunately what happened to the victims.
Yeah, it's so sad.
But there's. You know, there's other information that's being revealed just recently.
Oh, okay, so it's a deeper situation.
So we're still looking into that. We're working closely with the Lake County Sheriff's Department as well.
Great, okay, we look forward to hearing that.
Figure out exactly what happened, why it happened.
Another case of, you know, just young people, I don't know, it's so tragic how we lose them so fast.
We don't know, and I can't tell you from the Highway Patrol's perspective, this is something that I've asked our folks, our officers, our sergeants, that with every one of these tragic incidents, the ones that at least we have a direct investigative involvement that we look at those, we analyze it, and after we do a good job of investigating what happened, and then the next step to that is to ask ourselves, could we have prevented this?
Exactly.
And
that's what we want to know.
Is there a way that we can prevent, you know, these types of tragedies? Because it obviously affects a lot of people, right. Not only the person that lost their life, but the ripple effect
sure.
to the families and friends.
Sure.
So we do have an obligation to make sure that we look at it a little more closely.
You know, well, we appreciate that very much. And then, of course, there was just recently the hit and run up on Highway 20 over by Saratoga Springs. Was there any IDs made on that or any more descriptions of the vehicles or anything that we can possibly put out?
Right. That is a pretty much a new investigation. We haven't even been to the autopsy. I believe that's tomorrow. And we're trying to find out a little bit more information, you know, sadly from that tragic incident in terms of what happened to the victim. And because the reality is we don't know whether that's a homicide or it's actually an accident.
Okay.
And that's really where we stand
right.
at this stage.
I know they don't get a lot of foot traffic along that part of the road. I'm familiar with that. I used to live up there, so it is kind of suspicious in that level.
Okay, on a different kind of question here, and this is... No, I don't know how to even say this. All law enforcement has a hard job. I don't care if you're in East LA or South Phoenix or in lovely Clear Lake. It's still a hard job, even though people choose that career path. And I say that a lot. You know, people say, oh, they're dangerous situations. You chose that profession, and that comes good and bad with any position you have.
Sure.
Is there, what type of training do officers, and I'll say specifically to your agency, get in regards to trying to handle the more, I'll use the word morbid, which is probably not the right term, but when you see accidents happen, you see extremely injured individuals, or in some cases people that have passed, how do you mentally deal with that?
Yeah,
how do you separate that work versus personal? Because I know when I deal with I have my own accounting practice. So when I deal with clients who have issues with the IRS or things that have gone wrong financially with them, it's hard for me to separate that because I feel sympathy towards these individuals.
Sure.
So what type of training and how do you able to react to situations like that?
Do you ever get used to it?
You know what? I can't, you know, again, there's my personal perspective on that and how we all learn to deal with these issues. And then, of course, there's our training. And I'd like to say that from the Highway Patrol's perspective, I think we have a fantastic academy. Our training regimen is a little higher than many, and I think our standards are pretty high. Now, in terms of all police departments in California and sheriff's departments, we have to meet minimum standards by the Peace Officer Standards Training, or referred to POST training. So there are minimum standards. I believe that a lot of our departments, including our own, exceed those standards. Currently, our CHP Academy is 6.5 months.
Oof.
You know, there's a very unfortunate, a high attrition rate, only about 40%. There's about 60% that actually make it through. Mm-hmm. But unfortunately, and I don't know what this says about our society, but only about 3 or 4% actually get through the actual testing process and get to the academy.
Jeez.
And then how long do they usually stay with this area, in this area, once they arrive?
In terms of, you know, once they make their training, at least from the CHP's perspective, then they're sent to the field all over California, depending on the need and the void, the vacancies that exist.
Do you see a high turnover here, though?
No. Okay. Lake County does not. I mean,
that's good.
It's fantastic. That's another
thing. I know our friend Glenn has been with you guys for a while, and he transferred in from another area. So Glenn Thomas
is
a good friend of ours, and we appreciate it.
17 years. So.
Yeah.
Has it been that long?
Yeah, you?
Really?
Wow, that's fantastic.
So
that's what we like to hear.
Tremendous commitment.
We like it when we get pulled over and we know the officer is doing it.
Hey.
They're our friends.
Let's not go there.
It's a good thing, you know.
Sure.
I mean, if I do something wrong, I want to pay the price. Yeah. But, you know, if I do something wrong and I know the officer who's giving me the ticket, then I feel more comfortable. You know, I'm not going to mind it so much.
Well, actually, the one or two encounters we've had with CHP is that the officers have been extremely professional. I'm not saying that because you're here. I'm not that type of person. I'll tell like it is. Yeah. They've been very professional, very respectful. You know,
always.
If you did something wrong, they say, hey, you know, your taillight's out, dude. Why isn't it fixed?
Yeah.
Didn't have enough
Oops.
Time. I'm bad. I apologize. But, you know, always no attitudes, always been very professional. Yeah. And that's all you can expect out of any person.
Yeah.
It's good to hear.
It's good to see.
Every now and then a button gets pushed and an officer might have had the previous stop, the previous arrest might not have gone so well. So,
yeah. Oh, that is.
And I realize the public has attitudes occasionally.
Honestly, when you pull somebody over, I mean, a lot of times I think that people automatically put up these walls and defenses, thinking that they're going to have a negative experience. So it creates a negative energy when that happens, obviously, because you're going into a dangerous situation to begin with unknown people, and then they already come out off with a negative saying, oh, well, this is a cop, and I got to put my worst attitude up, you know, and it's a confrontational thing. And I think it makes it really difficult for your guys to take it from an objective perspective, as they try to do, I'm sure, you know, and they get hit with this negative before they even say hello to the person. Yeah.
Right. And
must
I think
be hard.
Really that tends to come, hopefully, at least in our county, you know, back to our vision here is trying to promote a sense of community with law enforcement.
Right.
That, you know, I've even spoken to our officers about this. You know, there's the verb to police, which is kind of what we're associated most with.
Mm-hmm.
And when you talk about law enforcement, you know, for the most part, a lot of people get this image of officers having to be very reactive
and sure.
having to, you know, address issues that are not very comfortable.
Right, right.
And hopefully through our community efforts of working with the public and letting them know that we really care about the community, that there's also the police, the noun, and what that means. And to us, it means all the programs that we have and how we can make a difference in preparing kids to drive safely.
I love that, yeah.
Making sure that even bars, we've recently kind of recreated or reestablished a relationship with ABC.
Oh, cool.
And we're trying to get their involvement with us. And
I wish that they would develop a program where there would be a mandatory, what do you call it, drive home, you know, for anybody who's impaired. That's just a free ride. You know, if there'd be some kind of funding that could support something like that, it would eliminate so many tragedies. Just that simple move.
Yeah. It would if people would take it.
Well, that's the other
half of the question.
You'd
yes.
have, there's a lot of, you know, again, there's social issues and that usually have all kinds of community connections. And that's why I think it's so important to work in partnership and getting communities out there in some of these cities, for example. On some of these holidays, you have merchants. Well, they'll actually pay. They put it into they create an organ, you know, a kitty, so to mm-hmm. speak. And
mm-hmm.
and on a certain holiday, if they're drinking at their pub, you know, you can get a free ride home. You know,
right.
within certain parameters.
That's great too.
You know, and I think those yeah. those types of things do help.
Right.
There's unfortunately some of those individuals that have a you know a bigger problem.
And that goes yeah. back to the whole thing about the mental health and getting people in rehab and trying to get them off. This idea that when you go have a drink, you have to get drunk. You know, go have a couple drinks. You don't need to get
and
smashed.
And I think some of those people are more responsible.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And I think, I believe getting your, you know, your pubs more involved, your restaurant that serve alcohol a little bit. I think, again, we're talking about ABC using them to help remind them that they do have a responsibility.
Absolutely.
In the community.
Right. I'm lucky. If I go out and enjoy a beer or two, which at my age with some of my physical difficulties, I can't function. I'm sound asleep. Terry doesn't drink. So I have my designated driver automatically. Oh. And if I do decide, most of the time, if I do have a beer or a glass
he's
of wine,
he's a two drink person.
I do it at home.
Done.
Where I can just fall sound asleep on the couch.
And it's even worse now because he's been diagnosed with epilepsy, sports-related, of course, from baseball and such. So, you know, he drinks two drinks and he's totally gone.
So I think if people use I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, just to your point about what we do for – do you ever get used to it or how do you deal with it? One of the things that I like about us is that we really kind of watch each other.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, good, yeah.
You know, you talk about these things. You don't just, you know, respond to these and then it's over
right.
and then let each other go.
Oh, good. So you do talk about them. That's important.
We
yeah.
do have on really critical incidents. We have the debriefings where we'll all sit around and talk about
good.
It. But just with your partners. I've always worked graveyard, so I've always had a partner and we're able to, you know, talk about it and stuff like that. But
mm-hmm.
you never know what's going to come and bother you. But even, and I think that's one thing that, you know, we talk about this county, how the people are. And I think we have to get better about keeping tabs on each other.
Right.
That's what I was saying.
Whether you're the bar owner,
know your neighbor.
Yep. Owner or whatever. You know, when those people come in, they drink at your establishment, feel responsible for them.
Mm-hmm.
Make
agreed.
Sure that they're not overdoing it or
exactly.
they have a ride home. And,
right.
You know, we got to, you know, we live in a small community for a reason. And we like that.
And we're all in this together.
Like it or not. I do have one question that hopefully I expressed it in the right way, is that, and this is not a private issue, is that it's been well publicized lately that law enforcement officers have allegedly gone beyond the call of duty in trying to deal with a specific situation, maybe getting
and
too,
even within the CHP,
yeah,
we've seen this
right,
recently.
Getting overly
yeah.
aggressive and handling a situation, maybe overreacting to a situation. Again, I say allegedly because I wasn't there. I don't know the facts. But it's perceived by the press and the citizens these days that law enforcement no longer is there to protect the citizens. It's there to be very aggressive in crime enforcement, for better mm-hmm. choice of words. So how do you react to that yourselves as officers? And then also, is there any type of training that you put forth to your officers to tell them, hey, you know, obviously you got to react to a situation, but here's the procedures you need
to reduce unnecessary aggressiveness and that kind of thing.
We do have a lot of training for officers. And as I said, I've been on a long time. And since I've been on the Highway Patrol, we've had a lot of tactics training, a lot of trainings on how to de-escalate things, issues or events that we respond to. And then there's also laws that say that you're supposed to de-escalate and only use that force necessary to overcome, you know, the force that you're up against. I think it's very unfortunate right now, and I honestly believe there's some misperception, because to your question about law enforcement and hostility or use of force issues, I believe that law enforcement all across this country deals with aggressive events in the hundreds of thousands, perhaps every day. And because we're in a position of trust, such as teachers and clergy, that we do have a higher responsibility. And every now and then, someone may go a little bit beyond. And those things happen.
Right.
And it's an opportunity, I think, for law enforcement to then take a deep breath and make sure that we're doing the right thing, that we are treating the public correctly, or if there's anything else that we need to do. Now, you know, to your question regarding the Highway Patrol, what are we doing about it? Well, right now, regarding dealing with, for example, folks that have mental illnesses that we're coming across, that right now our department has mandated more training. And we actually started doing this 2 years ago. For this year, our strategic plan requires that all sergeants be trained to a higher standard. And in fact, that's why I asked Corey. We were just very fortunate that this training came along, and we received 24 hours of training here. And we are creating, at least here in Lake County, that we're required to be doing this training. But I want to go above and beyond in terms of what resources are available for our officers, because it's good for them as well. We want to help the public, but we need to have resources to do that.
Right, and you also have to protect yourselves.
And then there's that issue. Our officers, they're human beings, they're dads, they're coaches, they're just like anybody else. And although we did take this oath to even lay down our life, if the call of duty calls for it, because that is the oath that we take on the Highway Patrol, it doesn't mean that we on the Highway Patrol and me in my own position have a responsibility to bring our officers home every day.
You know, it's funny. I had a friend who was on my baseball team when I lived in Arizona, a Highway Patrol officer, nice young man, big guy. When he was on the ball field, nicest guy I ever met. Just would give your shirt off his back. Just nothing. Just a great guy. Family guy, the whole thing. As soon as he put that uniform on, I'm glad he never stopped me on a traffic violation. He was a totally different attitude. And I, in hindsight, now I understand why. Because he has responsibility. You don't know when you pull over a vehicle who that person is. And in Phoenix especially, you know, there could be a weapon there and just shot on the spot, especially in the South Phoenix area, where the major gangs are related. So I understand to a certain extent. But so do your officers actually have a kind of a slight personality change from being off duty and a family person and once they put that uniform on?
I would like to say that I hope they do. I hope that they go into a mode of professionalism and recognizing their duty. So obviously, it's much different to get off work and go home and have a beer, and they should be able to unwind and decompress with their family and their friends. And then when they put the uniform on, they know that they represent the people, they represent our government, they represent the Highway Patrol, and that we're hopefully out there making the community safer.
Exactly, and that's what we appreciate. Now, just like any organization, there's going to be people who go overboard, who have issues, who take it to the next level, and that's to be expected to a certain extent. But, you know, the fact that in our neighborhood, we don't really have any issues with law enforcement as far as, like, dealing with the officers. As far as CHP is concerned, all the officers there seem to be very stable, mellow, you know, no attitudes, just doing their job. And we appreciate that.
Again, I can attest for our officers because most of them are tend to be like Corey, kind of homegrown. This is their community.
Exactly.
And they do want to
and
make
a
contribution.
Right.
Yeah.
And but it's not a simple job because when they get into, like I said, the verb mode of policing.
Exactly.
Right.
Yeah, people don't like to be called out.
Right.
Mm-mm. And you know, for lack of a better word, it's just really what ends up happening is people get caught doing something they're not supposed to be doing.
Right.
And they can make a lot of excuses for it, but they got caught.
Exactly.
And
exactly.
Our officers are paid to do their job.
Yeah. It's funny. Right. Early in the show, I mentioned in our rambling on about nothing that there was a Facebook post, which I never do Facebook, about, I'll say, criticizing law enforcement here in Lake County. And someone responded, and I don't know that many people here, said, you know, there's some really good people out there. They mentioned Officer White, who was in the Sheriff's Department, who actually responded to one of our concerns. Someone killed our goats, but it was a mountain lion. And then we mentioned Glenn. And so there are some really good officers out there. And I think there is a misconception at times by the public about what a law enforcement does, how they react to situations, because I don't think they put themselves in your shoes. They don't understand what job you have to do and some of the consequences that potentially could occur. So it was nice to see a citizen respond that says, you know, these guys are cool. They're really nice. They do their job. If you've done something wrong, they got to do their job. But they're good people. There's no attitudes that some media kind of addresses. So it was good to see someone respond in a positive way.
Yeah, it's great. It is refreshing to hear that because I do believe that the vast majority of law enforcement, and I can definitely speak for California because of the standards that we have, and my understanding is our standards are even higher for police officers right. in this state than other states. So we all have to go through training, and many of our departments have very stringent training standards. And, again, we have a high attrition rate just at our academy, just trying to
right.
get people out of there.
Right.
So I think our officers, especially right now, I don't agree with some of the perceptions because I think the vast majority of officers, we deal with violent confrontations every day. And we're able to successfully mitigate
right.
those. So I think when some of these things are almost taken out of context,
mm-hmm.
it's very unfortunate
right.
that certain parts of the media or certain communities are really not understanding what's going on. And it's really not fair, not only to law enforcement, it's not fair to the community because they start losing faith
right.
in their police agencies.
Well, absolutely.
Let me ask you
that's
this
the
then.
And,
well, some of our local politicians have town hall meetings, especially Mr. Steele, who since he's been elected is really getting involved in the community.
He's excellent.
Is it?
Yes.
Yeah, I like Jim. I mean, anyway, I can't vote for him because I wasn't in his district, but I do like Jim and I like his wife, Olga. Is it possible, are you allowed to actually have, quote, town hall meetings as representatives of CHP.
Like community outreach.
Yeah, where people can come and talk to you just like you're talking to us now and get a feeling and an understanding of your job, plus a one-on-one contact. I grew up in New York, and it was obvious that at that time, many years ago, there was patrol officers on foot. They
officer
knew their
on the beat.
They knew their community. They knew who was good, who was bad. They knew who had some, quote, problems. Who was on unemployment, who has some money, and they knew their community. There was a good interaction there. Today's society, unless you – I don't even know if there's any more patrol officers on foot.
And I think what I'm hearing, what I've read a little bit, is you're seeing more of that.
It's coming
again,
back.
That's a resource, but
yeah.
that's a resource issue.
Right.
Keep in
mm-hmm.
mind that if you're putting an officer on foot, he or she – does not have as much terrain that they can cover.
Right. And that's I realize true. In this type right. of area, it's almost impossible.
Well,
anyway.
Plus it's probably not a role CHP would be involved in because you're more in the highways and
yeah,
the major
and,
roads.
And highways
and stuff.
For us, obviously, are all unincorporated areas
right.
and primary jurisdiction on all freeways as well. But
so you're basically on all roads. It doesn't matter whether it's state road or county or whatever.
Yeah, the CHP has primary jurisdiction on traffic jurisdiction on all freeways in California, and we have the responsibility of doing all traffic law enforcement on all unincorporated areas as well. That is a primary function of the CHP.
I gotcha.
Okay. So are you allowed by your own internal rules to have community meetings?
You know, I'm glad you bring that up because we're actually, and you bring up Mr. Steele that I've met with on a couple times. Now we actually, you're right. He actually, I've met with all of the County Board of Supervisors in some capacity, whether it's at their meeting or dealing with them individually. And I think they're they're all engaged. They all have interests in their community. And Mr. Steele, he's addressing a lot of the needs in the lake, you know, on the east side, as we call it. And as a result, here a few months ago, he invited us to a town hall meeting, and I went with one of our sergeants. And in fact, last night, they've also developed a neighborhood watch program.
Excellent.
And we have been understanding the needs that they have, and we've been doing more enforcement, more community outreach in that area. And in fact, we've assigned from Clear Lake an officer that's actually addressing those needs. And last night, they had another neighborhood watch meeting at the Lucerne Church. So we are very much interested in being involved in those community events.
Excellent.
Where we can
Excellent.
Speak and awesome. Hear personally what the needs of the members are, of the public, and address them specifically.
Excellent, excellent. Well, we didn't finish our list, but we're almost out of time, and we have to get ready for the news at noon. Not your normal news, as we call it. We do a live show every Monday, Wednesday, Friday at noon that has all the latest stories. So we're trying to, you know, bring information to the people. One of the questions that we did have on there, maybe quickly we can ask that. What do you feel the media's role is in helping to inform the citizens, and what more can we do to try to keep that door open as far as information is concerned?
Do you want to address that, or I know you deal. He deals with the media quite a bit, and I can kind of elaborate a little bit as well. But.
Yeah, I think you guys do a great job. All our media in the county, I think they do a great job of making sure that people are aware, and they're very conscientious of things. They're not just putting, you know, garbage out there.
Right. Right. Yeah. Yeah. We try hard not to.
Conscientious about what they're putting out there. So I think that. Good, it is a good thing. I think it's more on our end. I wish I had a way to, you know, we talk about violent incidents. One of our officers stopped a car and there was a gun in the car the other day, and you know, we had that incident, which is kind of newsworthy and people should know. But you know, I get the information late because you know, and then it's really not that pertinent anymore.
Yeah, once the issue's done. Yeah.
Yeah, it's I want to develop a way where I can be more effective for you guys. I think you guys.
Yeah, I know we're missing a lot.
You guys
definitely.
Do a great job. I mean, we put out the press releases for the Start Smart programs for the bicycle rodeos. You guys got it on there that day. You know, and that's the kind of stuff that you know we appreciate because we're trying to educate the public as much as possible, especially reaching out to teens. And parents as well to get their kids with helmets on out there.
Yeah, well, let's take a minute here and talk about the bike rodeo. Let's just do that real quick. It's next Saturday, correct?
The 18th of July.
Yes.
It'll be from 9 a.m. to about 3. A lot of skill courses out there for the kids.
Not like a fun, I mean, it's fun, but it's not like your typical idea of a rodeo where you're going to be roping and looping.
It's a lot of skills.
A loose
courses.
Term we use, but
yeah, we just did one not too long ago for about 100 bikes or so.
Mark, there's a couple pictures on the stick there on that if you want to throw them up.
And they, the thing that's really good about it, and we always comment on it when we're doing them, is you can see the kids get better as they go through them because they'll do the same skills course, you know, until they succeed at it and do really well at it. So we just keep pushing them to do it. And it's just amazing. The skill level just gets better and better and better.
And how many times are you going to be doing this? Once a year, a couple times a year, do you think?
Hopefully at least once, hopefully two times a year as we can, you know, working around weather and venues. And I can tell you that it's this particular event that we're having, we have full support from all of our law enforcement partners. Lakeport, Clear Lake, the Sheriff's Department.
Awesome.
You know, the fire department. So everybody, we're obviously first responders, and we have a genuine concern in our kids.
Even though I hate getting up early on Saturdays, would you object if I came out with a our cameras and did some video of the event and maybe interview. Who? What officer is going to be in charge of that?
You're looking at him.
Oh, that's right.
So may I come in
now? Article.
And
without the interview video,
No. I got to do some little bit of an interview. So
I'd be happy to talk to you.
Would you object to that at all?
No, we'd love to have
you. Oh, that'd be great.
And it
starts at what time?
It starts at 9 a.m.
9 a.m. Now, we do have an event here at 1 o'clock.
I know, that's what I'm saying, but I can get out there.
After the rodeo, there's going to be a barbecue, hot dogs.
Hot dog barbecue. I got that in there already.
Okay, you can do your show on your own. I'm going to stay in
here. Also, we're going to have helmets there.
Yes, there'll be some helmets for those kids that don't have them.
And we're asking anybody from the public if they want to donate a helmet, go to Walmart, buy one, bring it to one of the offices.
I got some extra motorcycle helmets.
That won't work.
But bring those down, and we'll make sure a kid gets them.
Cool.
Excellent. Well, we're so excited that you're here, and I really appreciate the work that you guys do, and want to thank you so much for coming and talking to us, and I hope you would consider being maybe, monthly, quarterly or something, come on a regular basis, just to give folks a touch base and let them know where you're at, and anything that's upcoming, we'll be happy to have you come back on anytime.
Well, we're very grateful that you allowed us this time segment, and we would love to come on at least once a quarter.
Excellent.
That would be great.
Let you know what's going on in our community from our perspective.
Sheriff Martin has the same arrangement. Yeah. We like to just touch base with law enforcement and get their pulse right at the moment. That's really important to us.
Well, again, thank you very much for having us.
Thank you. It's a mutual. Okay. So thank you.
All right. All right. That about does it for today, guys. And we're going to take a quick break as we switch over to do Lake County Magazine LCM TV News at Noon. And I'm Terry Larson.
And I'm Pete the Tax Guy.
And thanks for joining us, and thanks to our guests.
Hey there, brother, did you have a nice sleep? Wipe the crust from your eyes so you can see. Did your mama tuck you in? Did you have a nice dream? If you're hungry, we can fix you something to eat. It just started raining and it got a little cold, and the grass is getting wet. You need someone that you can hold. You've been out all night running around, looking for something to hold you down. You know all the other kids just want to play, and you're the one trying to fix the world today. You got the heart of a child in a grown man's skin. You're not gonna lose, but you know that you might not win. You know you gotta grow older and you gotta grow up, but you don't have to change all that much. Gotta let the world just come to you. When the seasons change, you know we can too. And it's almost autumn, let life be new. And it's almost autumn, let life be new.
love the way you touch me and the way it smells so sweet. I love your juicy kisses and the way they cover me. I love your skin, I love your hair, I love your little feet. I love the feel of being in love. I love the way you hold me when I'm feeling insecure. Your love is like a mountain stream, refreshing and so pure. I love you for your honesty, yeah, that's what love is for. I love the feel of being in love. Darkness comes to us all sometimes, but your touch makes me feel so good. I know you were sent for me, 'cause I prayed and I prayed and I knew that you would come to me. I love you just to love you and for being my best friend. You know I'll always love you even to the bitter end. I'll love you the next time around if we come back again. I love the feel of being in love. All sometimes, but your touch makes me feel so good.